Good morning and welcome to the 16th meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2024. First item of agenda is consideration of the Circular Economy Bill at Stage 2, and I say at Day 1 of the Stage 2 debate. I'd like to welcome Gillian Martin, the Minister for Energy, Just Transition and Fair Work, and her supporting officials. The following non-committee members will be present today to move amendments. There's Sarah Boyack, who's here, Maurice Golden, who's here, Claire Adamson, who's online, and Graham Simpson will be attending as well. Sarah and Maurice are both speaking in the first debate. Claire is not, but Graham is not either. So welcome to those committee members. As this is day one of the Stage 2 proceedings, and as this is in fact the first time this committee has had a Stage 2 proceedings, I'm going to briefly outline how the proceedings work. Members should have with them or on their laptop a copy of the bill as introduced. They should also have a marshalled list of amendments which sets out the amendments in the order in which they will be disposed of, and the groupings which sets out the amendments in the order in which they will be debated. These documents are available on the bill webpage on the Scottish Parliament's website for anyone that's watching. There will be one debate on each group of amendments. The member who lodged the first amendment in any group will speak to and move that amendment, and then, if they wish, speak to other amendments in the group. I'll then call the other members with amendments in the group to speak to, but not move their amendments, and speak to other amendments in the group if they so wish. I'll then call any other members who wish to speak in the debate, and if you wish to speak, you should indicate that to me or to the clerks. I'll then call the minister if she has not already spoken in the debate, and finally I'll call the member who moved the first amendment in the group to wind up. At that point, they should indicate whether they wish to press or withdraw the amendment. If the amendment is pressed, I will put the question on the amendment. If they now wish to withdraw their amendment, I will ask whether any member present objects. If there is an objection, I must put the question on the amendment. Later amendments in a group are not debated again when they are reached, if they are moved. I'll put the question on them straight away. If a member whose amendment has already been debated does not wish to move it when it's called, they simply say not moved. Unless anyone else then says the amendment is moved, I will move on to the next amendment on the marshalled list. If there's a division, I just remind committee members it is them that may vote, and the choices are yes, no, or abstain. So, as all members of the committee are present, voting will be by a show of hands, and it's important that you keep your hands raised clearly until the clerk has recorded your name. Looks like we're ready to go, and I stress it's day one, and it'll be interesting to see how far we get today. I make no promises, I'm in your hands. So I first call Amendment 92 in the name of Sarah Boyack, group with Amendment 131. Sarah Boyack to move Amendment 92 and speak to all amendments in the group. Sarah.
Thank you very much, Convener, and also for running through exactly what the instructions are for how we move and not move our amendments today. And also welcome to the Minister in this role. Amendment 92 in my name would insert a section on the purpose of a circular economy. A number of stakeholders have called for a purpose section, and I'm very grateful to the APRS for supporting the drafting of my amendment. And I opted for a purpose rather than a definition, because I think a definition of a circular economy might be too narrow for what we're trying to achieve with this bill, and also to reflect that change is happening in relation to the circular economy agenda. But by having a purpose section in the bill, it will actually help provide clarity on what we want a circular economy to look like in Scotland. That will help ensure that the strategy and the targets that will be created as a result of the bill will be coherent. And it also sends a signal to industry and consumers so that everyone can consider their actions and behaviours and think about what they can change to make sure that goods, products and materials can keep in use for longer, and not just talking about the waste hierarchy, but getting on and managing waste in line with it. And a purpose section would also send a signal to the wider public sector. Local authorities are taking decisions every day now on managing their waste services, and setting out the purpose of a circular economy here in Scotland would help them make decisions for the long term to make sure we progress towards a circular economy now and towards that long term. On Amendment 131, in the name of Maurice Golden, it's very similar to my amendment and contains a number of the same features. And if members agree with setting out the purpose of a circular economy on the face of the bill today, I would ask that you agree with my amendment. But I would be happy to look at amendments to achieve cross-party consensus at stage three, because I hope there's an appetite to strengthen the bill today. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Sarah. Maurice Golden, I now call you to speak to Amendment 131 and any other amendments in the group. Maurice.
Thanks, Convener. And the committee may have wanted one purpose amendment, and they've got two to choose from, so I think that's very beneficial. I think it's really important in terms of accountability for the Scottish Government that we have an indication of the purpose of the bill on the face of the bill. I think there are many similarities between Sarah Boyack's amendment and mine. I think, in addition to that, if either is chosen, that there would be subsequent opportunity to tighten it up at stage three, which I think would be useful for the bill. I think on 131A, I think it is very important to have the goods, products, materials are circulated in as high a value state for as long as possible in order to extract the maximum economic, social, environmental value from them, and that would be beneficial. But I think ultimately it's for the committee to decide which of those purpose clauses can aid our movement towards a circular economy and improve the bill.
Thanks very much, Maurice. Does any other member wish to speak in this? Monica.
Thank you, Convener, and welcome also to the Minister and her officials. I think these are really helpful amendments from Sarah Boyack and Maurice Golden. I think having a purpose of circular economy on the bill is really helpful and is common sense. So I can see there's a lot of similarity between the amendments. I think in terms of Sarah Boyack's amendment, it is helpful to see the explicit reference to reduction of the use of virgin materials, but I think there's really common ground here, and also recognise that stakeholders have been very helpful. So I would be minded to support 131 today in Sarah Boyack's name, but hopefully further discussion can take place in that cross-party agreement, because I've got my numbers mixed up. Amendment 92 is Sarah Boyack's. Here we go. The similarities. I would support Sarah Boyack's Amendment 92. I think Maurice Golden's is very similar, but some of the language is a bit tighter, and hopefully we can see some cross-party agreement on that today.
Thank you very much, Monica. Does anyone... Mark?
Yeah, thanks very much, Convener. I certainly take on board a lot of the comments from stakeholders about the need for clarity in this bill, but I'm a little bit concerned about, you know, effectively creating a fixed definition of a circular economy at this point that is fixed and immovable and can't then change over time. We're in a rapidly developing sector, rapidly developing understanding of circular economy, so I'd appreciate perhaps some thoughts from the movers of the amendments on that in winding up. And also I suppose it's a precedent in terms of setting a purpose clause within legislation in circular economy. I'd be interested to know, are there other areas of legislation where a purpose clause has actually been beneficial in terms of focusing legislation in a particular area? I'm not aware of that, but, you know, again, I'll note with interest the comments of the Minister and the comments of Sarah Boyack in closing.
OK, thank you. No other members indicated they wish to speak. Minister.
Convener, whilst I understand the sentiments behind Amendments 92 and 131, I'm afraid I cannot support them. In the first place, both amendments claim to set out a purpose for a circular economy for the whole of this bill, but in reality, they simply attempt to describe a circular economy. Specifically, Amendment 92 describes a circular economy with reference to the waste hierarchy, and both amendments refer to just transition principles under the Climate Change Scotland Act 2009. I strongly agree that the waste hierarchy and just transition principles are important considerations, and that's why the Scottish Government has proposed Amendments 136 and 137, which require that Scottish ministers have specific regard to both of these when preparing a circular economy strategy. Amendments 136 and 137 have direct legal effect and will allow Parliament to hold ministers to account for the content of the strategy itself, which will provide an overall framework for wider policy in this area. In contrast, Amendments 92 and 131 are not linked to the substantive sections of the bill, nor do they impose any duties or obligations, so they would actually have no legal effect. The term circular economy only appears in sections 1 to 7 of the bill, and the remaining sections of the bill mostly amend other legislation. In the bill as introduced, section 1, page 3, and section 6, page 2, set out a list of criteria of what constitutes a circular economy that ministers must have regard to when preparing the strategy and making regulations to set targets. Unlike the proposed purpose clause in either Amendment 92 or 131, this list of criteria of what constitutes a circular economy has legal effect because ministers must have regard to those matters when preparing the strategy and making regulations to set targets. In addition, and I think this was Mark Ruskell's point, one of Mark Ruskell's point, there is no accepted international definition of circular economy, and including one in the bill risks terminology becoming outdated. So in short, convener, the Scottish Government's view is that the amendments don't work legally and therefore would not add value to what's already in the bill. And on that basis, I'm afraid I can't support them.
Thank you, Minister. Sarah Boyack, can I ask you to wind up and press a withdrawal amendment 92, please?
Thanks very much, convener. Well, it's good to get colleagues' feedback on this. I think the overall ambition here is to strengthen this bill, because it was commented on a number of occasions that this is a recycling bill, not a circular economy bill. So it's to strengthen that right from the start, to highlight that and to reflect the need that we need to be ambitious, but not overly ambitious. And that's why I didn't try to go for a definition and get a world first for a definition, but actually to try and use what's out there already. Monica's comment about the reduction of use of virgin materials, very much welcomed. And the comments by Mark about the need for clarity, totally accept that. That's partly what we're trying to do here. But it's also about trying to get people to gear up and to think about how they invest now, because the worry about not being strong enough in terms of the circular economy elements is that we're looking more at the recycling end of the spectrum, not thinking about before that how we redesign, how we repurpose, reuse. So that's why we tried to put this amendment like this. And the comments from the Minister, I think it is good that we think about waste hierarchy and just transition right from the start, because that has to involve everything that happens thereafter, and it is to try and to deliver a joined-up approach. So very much welcome the fact that the Minister did put in, or that numbers 1, 3, 6 and 7 were also submitted. And I do very much want that joined-up but also ambitious approach, and I think it has to start at the very beginning of this bill. So I will push it, convener. I will not make any expectations, because there's a competition in the room. But just to get it going, I think we should have this at the start of the bill, what's in the content of my amendment. And happy to talk to colleagues afterwards if we can tighten things for stage three. Thank you, convener.
Thank you very much, sir. Just for clarity, I know it would be unusual, but if in with a committee of seven, that if it does come down to a casting vote, so the committee are aware, I will always cast my casting vote as convener in the same way I voted on the amendment, just so there's no doubt about that for continuity. So that's the way it will be. So the first question is that Amendment 92 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not agreed. Okay. So therefore, we'll move to a vote. Can I ask those in favour? Thank you. Those in favour, please raise your hands. Okay. Sorry, it's going to take time because the clerks have to record every single name, so I want to make sure it's entirely correct. Those against, please raise your hands. And there are no abstentions. So, those... Those in favour are yes. Those in favour are three. Those against are four. Therefore, the motion is not carried. Amendment's not carried. I call Amendment 131 in the name of Maurice Golden, already debated with Amendment 92. Maurice Golden to move or not move?
Not moved.
Thank you. Looking round, no one else wants to move that amendment. So, thank you. I now move on to call Amendment 93 in the name of Sarah Boyack, group with amendments as shown in the groupings. I must point out that if Amendment 140 is agreed to, I cannot call Amendment 122 because of a preemption. Sarah Boyack, please move Amendment 93 and speak to the amendments in the group. Sarah.
Thank you, Convener. We move for two amendments to rather a lot of amendments in this group. I've got a number of amendments in this group which try again to enhance the circular economy, but focusing on the strategy. And the first couple of amendments in my name seek to strengthen the presence of the just transition principles within the bill. Amendment 93, which I move, would require Scottish ministers to set up in the strategy how the just transition principles are applied. And that's backed up by Amendment 98, which would require Scottish ministers to have regard to the just transition principles in preparing the strategy. Amendment 99 in my name clarifies that where the just transition principles are referenced in this section, they have the same meaning as the Climate Change Scotland Act 2009. And those principles are the importance of reducing emissions in Scotland, that support environmentally and socially sustainable jobs, that support low carbon investment infrastructure, that develop and maintain social consensus through engagement with workers, trade unions, communities, non-governmental organisations, representatives of the interests of business industry, and such other persons as the Scottish ministers consider appropriate. Creates decent, fair and high quality work in a way which doesn't negatively affect the current workforce and overall economy, and contributes to resource efficient and sustainable economic approaches which help address inequality and poverty. And the Just Transition Partnership are very keen to see the principles on the face of this bill in the section which was referenced in the committee's report. And I know there's a lot of evidence the committee took, and I know there's a lot of reflections that went into your recommendations. Amendment 181... in my name would also require ministers to act in accordance with the Do No Harm principle in the Circular Economy Strategy, with Amendment 213 clarifying the definition of the principle to be used within the bill. Amendments 94, 95, 96 and 97 in my name would strengthen the terminology in the face of the bill, and this was a particular ask of Friends of the Earth Scotland as referenced in the committee report. When you look at the dictionary definition of the word thing, it refers to an object that cannot be precisely described. And I think it would leave us in a precarious position in terms of using this bill to help us achieve the circular economy, particularly to ensure that materials are not just objects captured in the scope of the legislation. So I have a strong preference for goods, products and materials. I think that's so much better than things, and I think it really would help stakeholders and those that will be actually implementing this bill on a day-to-day basis. Amendment 184 in my name would see the waste hierarchy containing the seven R's of waste management contained on the face of the bill. This amendment would require ministers to have regard to the waste hierarchy when developing the circular economy strategy. I appreciate that in Amendment 136, the Scottish Government would look to adopt the hierarchy set out in the EU Waste Directive framework. However, I do feel that the waste hierarchy, as I've proposed, is gaining traction globally. It helps both producers and consumers to rethink their behaviour when it comes to the goods, products and materials they are using every day. And so that when it comes to the end of life products or use, they don't just automatically put it in the bin, but they consider if there's a further use. And hopefully in terms of circular economy, it will actually get people to think further up the waste stream to actually think about how they design in the first place so that products can be reused. So I'll go back to the point I made in my opening comments. I'm concerned we're not being a bit ambitious enough. For instance, the hierarchy proposed by the Scottish Government contains disposal and other recovery, and it'd be useful to get clarity from the Minister on whether that covers incineration and whether it sits with or in opposition to the Scottish Government's moves in the long term to move away from incineration. Amendment 212 in my name builds on the commitment to product stewardship as detailed in the circular economy route map, and it's on the back of suggestions from the APRS, who again I very much thank for helping in drafting. I hope I've captured their comments in my speech today. Producer responsibility and product stewardship are key areas where we can take concrete action in line with the waste hierarchy to redesign so that products are designed from scratch, I mentioned that earlier, and to be kept in use for as long as possible. It encourages better product design, especially for the durability and efficient recovery, and it inverts the current incentive in structures which favour producers who externalise more of their costs onto the environment rather than what their competitors do. And Amendment 212 would put product stewardship on a statutory footing and ensure that a plan is developed so that producers have clear intentions from the Scottish Government. With EPR, many businesses are now already working on this, and a product stewardship plan, I believe, would help further that work.
Would the member take an intervention?
Aye. You've managed to get in almost my last line, of course.
Thank you for taking intervention on 212. It was really just to understand a little bit more in terms of the producer take back, you know, how that could work when we have sort of UK supply chains, how it would work across different borders within the UK. Do you think that would be compatible with the UK Internal Market Act, or is that something that would have to be investigated a little bit further down the line?
I think part of this is about governments working together and giving each other heads up on what they're doing and having proper intergovernmental work. And I think there are lessons to be learned from the DRS. Somebody's going to mention that in this discussion today. So I think, yes, it is doable if we have the right constructive approach. And I think businesses who've lobbied us all over the last couple of years, that's what they want to see as well. They're not against innovation. It's about having early information and being able to work collaboratively and constructively with government. I'm coming to my end, convening, you'll be delighted to hear. There are other really important amendments being proposed in this section, which I also think would strengthen the bill. So I'm very much looking forward to the discussion. I think amendments you've got in here from Mark Ruskell, Maurice Golden, Monica Lennon, Lorna Slater, Claire Adamson, Ben McPherson. It's really unusual to support so many amendments from other colleagues, but I think there's a constructive raft of amendments coming in this section. And I hope all of these, I think, in different ways are looking to strengthen the bill, make it more effective and genuinely promote delivery of a circular economy. So I've moved my own amendment and I hope colleagues will be constructive and be keen to support my amendments in this section. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Sarah. Monica Lennon, to speak to Amendment 132 and other amendments in the group. Monica.
Thank you, Convener. And just following on from Sarah Boyack, it's quite a big section in terms of amendments, but I think that is important. We really want the strategy to be strong and effective and to hopefully lead to policy coherence. So I have a few amendments in this group, 132, 134 and 185, all with the aim of improving the content of the strategy. 132 will do this by ensuring that the circular economy strategy considers the impact of material consumption in Scotland on the rest of the world. And this could be, for example, items of so-called fast fashion, which are, you know, bought in Scotland frequently and end up in landfill overseas. So it's about how we are more thoughtful about that. Again, bringing it back to stage one and the important evidence that we heard from stakeholders. We heard from Circular Communities Scotland about the example of the Atacama Desert in Chile, and the appeal to us that we shouldn't be adding to the problem in Scotland, but helping to reduce it. And I should say today, in the spirit of circularity, this dress I'm wearing to stage two today was from a local Swish event by a local business where they asked people to bring along clothes and do a bit of a clothes swap to try and divert unwanted clothing ended up in landfill and been shipped overseas. So a small action, but I think it also shows that locally, businesses like the Parkville and Blantyre and Angels and Uddingston are backing these kind of initiatives. So if anybody's wondering about the dress, in case they recognise it as their own, that's where it's come from. Of course.
Thank you. No, I'm not going to ask where I can buy the clothes for myself. It was really just to try and understand a little bit more around 132 and in terms of trying to measure that impact. How is that something we could measure, and how would we monitor that? So I'm really struggling to understand.
Yeah, no, it's a really good question from Douglas Lumsden. We can talk about the dress later. But in terms of 132, I mean, it simply says must consider and account for the extraterritorial impact of material consumption in Scotland. So consider and account. So it's not an overly prescriptive amendment here, but we need to start thinking about the different tools and mechanisms and data that's available. So it is about getting better at reporting, and I'll come out to talk about my other amendments which do make us think a bit more about due diligence, about public procurement, but it's really wrapped up in what Sarah Boyack talked about in terms of just transition. So if we simply say at this level, oh, it's too difficult, therefore we'll not put anything onto the bill, we wouldn't really make the changes that we need to make. But I think if it's something that Douglas Lumsden can't support today, hopefully we could have a further conversation about. 134 would strengthen the strategies care and regard for due diligence, which I've just mentioned, in respect of environmental protection and human rights. And a couple of weeks ago, I sponsored Fashion Revolution Scotland. They had a stand near the chamber. I know many members here stopped to chat and sewed on buttons on the map of Scotland. But again, that was about fun and getting people to have a conversation. But it was also to reflect on some of the environmental and human rights disasters that have happened in the name of fast fashion and other economic activities, like Rana Plaza, the disaster in Bangladesh, which cost the lives of thousands of people and left many others with life-changing injuries. So what we do in Scotland has an impact. And I would say my amendments support Sarah Boyack's Amendment 181, which requires ministers to act in accordance with the Do No Harm principle, as called for by SCIAF and Ciembra Columbia in their joint submission to the committee. And my amendments are supported by Friends of the Earth Scotland, and I'm grateful for that support. If I can just maybe speak to a couple of the other amendments, convener.
Now's your chance.
I'm looking at you for guidance. Sarah Boyack's amendments 93, 98, 99 would align the bill with just transition principles, which I've mentioned. And I think, you know, those of us who've studied this closely will know that was a key recommendation of our stage one report. And it's really important that just transition runs through all areas of government policy, strategy and legislation. I recognise that Amendment 137, supported by the Minister, also seeks to achieve this. I have a little concern that might not be strong enough, as it only requires the strategy to have regard for just transition principles. Sarah Boyack's amendment strengthens this requirement and will ensure the strategy is properly aligned with the principles. 137A by Maurice Golden seeks to strengthen the Minister's amendment by including a more comprehensive list of items that the strategy must have regard for. However, it does not solve the weakness inherent in that language of regard. I also support amendments 182, 183 and 186 in the name of Mark Ruskell. 182 would bring further clarity around the relationship of the strategy to transition minerals and how we can improve in this important area. And while they have the same general aim of ensuring that the waste hierarchy is included in the strategy, Amendment 184 in the name of Sarah Boyack is stronger than 136 supported by the Minister. But I'd be interested to hear the Minister's comments. on this. I'll get all my questions out now. I've got a question about Amendment 209, which is Bob Dorsey's, which Bob can hopefully speak to. It's just some of the language there. It talks about regions of Scotland. And although 209's got important provisions, I'm just keen to understand why it refers to regions rather than, for example, council areas or local authority areas. 140, back to Maurice Golden, aligns the strategy more with the Climate Change Act 2019 on the whole, and I support this. I would like to highlight Amendment 122 in the name of Ben McPherson, which, if I'm correct, will be knocked out if we back Amendment 140. I would like to, because I welcome the amendment, I just wondered if there's a way that that could be brought back later if it, you know, if it doesn't make it today. That was about the construction waste, and as the convener of the Cross Party Group on Construction, I know that industry and others are constantly looking ways to innovate around circular economy and the climate crisis. So there's a lot of support for the inclusion of that type of amendment in the bill. So I'd be interested to see what happens with that one. But I'll stop there, convener.
Thank you very much, Monica. Mark Ruskell, can you speak to Amendment 182 and other amendments in the group? Mark?
Yeah, thanks very much, convener. So I'll speak first to 182 and 186, which is about addressing the use of key minerals, sometimes they're called transition minerals, in our move towards a green energy transition. And I think members will be, you know, aware of many of the social and environmental impacts of minerals like lithium, cobalt, nickel, iron ore, copper, all absolutely critical for the development of renewable energy and battery systems. And I would acknowledge that the renewable energy industry itself is doing increasingly impressive work on circularity and work on addressing some of the impacts of transition minerals. But you know, we do need to go further, because we're in a process now where the rollout of renewable energy is going to continue apace. The limitations on these minerals is not going away. So we need a focus and a plan, I think, from government to drive this. So I'd acknowledge that, you know, Scotland currently doesn't have a kind of strategy for renewable energy for the renewable energy sector for sourcing these minerals. The UK does have a critical minerals strategy, and although I think there's an acknowledgement in the draft energy strategy of the role of these minerals, there isn't exactly a kind of plan at the moment that's going to ensure that their availability and the environmental and social impacts of their use will be addressed going forward. So my proposed amendments, 182, 186, would require the circular economy strategy to include improvement plans for transition minerals for the energy sector, and that would promote a more responsible and resilient approach to securing these essential resources. And I hope that the government will be open to working with me on a way forward on that. Can I also then turn to my amendment 183, and this is linked actually with another amendment which we'll come to later, 191. This addresses concerns from Environment Link that ministers need to give priority to the most damaging materials that are circulating in the economy. Now, I've resisted putting in a specific list of what those materials are, because I think over time that will change, but members will obviously be aware of some of the more problematic materials at the moment, like the forever chemicals, the PFAS chemicals that we're seeing in packaging. Flame retardants in mattresses or upholstered furniture is a particular problem at the moment. So what this amendment does is it adds a requirement to ministers in section 1.3 to have regard to processes for designing and distributing products to focus in on particular minerals that are the most harmful and polluting over their life cycle. So it really is up then for government, you know, to determine what the most problematic materials are. Yeah, sure, Mr. Simpson, yeah.
Thanks very much for taking the intervention. I'm just curious, I know Mark Ruskell is saying he would like to leave this to government, but it is his amendment, and the wording is giving priority materials which are most harmful or polluting. I just wonder how he thinks we would define that, how we would, you know, actually establish what is most harmful or indeed polluting.
Well, thankfully, although we've left the European Union, we still have a vast amount of environmental regulation that defines those materials that are polluting, which are problematic, which impact on human health. And we also, of course, have Environmental Standards Scotland, which is constantly reviewing existing legislation and making suggestions to government and agencies about how we can better enforce that legislation, how we can also change the law and enhance environmental protection. So I would say to Mr. Simpson that, you know, that process of developing environmental legislation is continuous. And indeed, there will be, you know, new materials, new scientific evidence that will continually come forward and change our understanding about which materials are problematic in terms of their impact on human health and environment. So I don't think it's right to kind of fix in time today a list of problematic chemicals, given that that scientific understanding and the work of our regulators continues apace, both within the European Union and outside the European Union as well. So I do think this is one for flexibility. And as members will recognise, you know, the danger of putting a list into legislation, we've got a lot of lists being brought forward here this morning, is that you leave something out. And you leave something out because you don't think it's a problem now, but of course it can be a problem going forward. So I believe, in answer to that question, that, you know, the process of environmental regulation is robust enough to ensure that, you know, we'll be able, government will be able to choose to take action on those particular materials that are problematic going forward. Okay, I think that's pretty much all the comments I've got. I mean, I was struck actually, though, by one comment that Sarah Boyack made about Amendment 136, which is the Minister's amendment, the Minister's alternative amendment in relation to embedding the waste hierarchy into this legislation. And I think she made the point about where incineration kind of sits within that waste hierarchy. So obviously, the government's made substantial progress in weaning ourselves off incineration in this country, and certainly, you know, prohibiting the development of more waste incinerators where they're unnecessary. So I'd be interested in hearing views from the Minister about how that approach to waste hierarchy puts incineration in its appropriate place, which is right at the bottom. Right at the bottom. We should not be relying on incineration anymore. That's me.
Okay, thank you very much. Bob Dorris, can you please speak to Amendment 208 and other amendments in the group? Bob.
Thank you, Convener. It's been a really interesting debate so far. Just transition has become a kind of buzz phrase in recent months, but we've already heard, what does it actually mean in practice? If you're a worker, if you're a business, if you're a community dependent on a particular sector to keep your local economy going, what does it mean in practice? And that got me to working with the Just Transition Partnership to try and flesh out what that might actually mean in practice and how the strategy could take account of that. So Amendment 208 asked the Scottish Government to outline the potential impact on workforce, on communities, on employers and on regions of the impact and delivery of any circular economy strategy with regards to a just transition. I'll return to the regions later. Monica had referred to that. I will come back to that. And Amendment 209 asks government to include a plan and how it will support those impacted. So can we identify how this strategy could impact on the workforce, on communities, on employers, on regions? But identifying it's clearly not enough. We have to take appropriate actions to support all those that will be impacted. And that's what 208 and 209 tries to achieve. We just look at the scale of some of the sectors. If you look at construction, there's 231,000 people employed by construction in Scotland based on a census in 2023. It was worth £13 billion to the Scottish economy in 2022. But if you ask people in construction whether they'd recommend that as a career to others, 28% would not recommend it as a career. But that sector needs 4,000 new employees every year to wash its face and to keep going as a sector. So there's a vital sector of the Scottish economy that clearly should actually be impacted by the circular economy bill. That's the point. But it has to be done in a just and appropriate and planned way. I could refer to agriculture, which has got nearly 67,000 employees. And that's perhaps a particularly good one to pick because of the very regionalised aspects of much of the jobs that agriculture services, but also the additional add-on value it has to sustaining local economies. I would say to Monica Lennon that I picked regions because you have to pick a terminology somehow. The impact of the circular economy bill and the strategy could straddle local authority areas. So do we pick a political boundary or do we just say region? I'm really open-minded as to what that looks like. Now I get that... Yes, Mr. Simpson?
Can I thank Bob Doris for taking the intervention? I'm curious to know what he means by regions. Does he mean regions as in Scottish parliamentary terms? Does he mean the old-style regions that we used to have in Scotland? I'm just not clear. And you know, when we have something in law, we need to be clear what we mean. And my second question would be very similar. What does he mean by communities? Because that could mean different things to different people.
I thank Mr. Simpson for those interventions. I hope they're intended to be helpful interventions, seeking clarity for what's in the face of the bill rather than an intervention that would go against the policy aims. Now, I suppose in relation to regions, I mean geographical areas, but I can see that perhaps, I'm not certain more clarity is needed, but I think Mr. Simpson makes a point that perhaps it might be, and that is something that I could reflect on. And likewise, we've had this debate on communities before. Do we mean communities as in within smaller geographical areas, or do we mean communities of interest? So again, I can see there could, I'm not convinced there is a need for more clarity, Mr. Simpson, but I could see how an argument could be made that perhaps more clarity might be desirable. Now, this takes it all to... I absolutely will. Yes, Monica Lennon.
Thank you. And thank you for the clarification. I heard what you said about just transition has become a bit of a buzzword, but I think it's important that we keep reminding ourselves and everyone else that the just transition cause has come from workers themselves, it's come from trade unionists. So when we talk about just transition, it's very much rooted in the experience of workers. And we need a worker-led transition. So again, I do really welcome 208. Having heard Bob Doherty's explanation, I'm less concerned about the definition around regions and communities. I think we can maybe look at that again after stage two. But it strikes me that given the intention is about, you know, advancing just transition, then it is about that place-based approach as well. So you think about, you know, Grangemouth, for example, which obviously is very important in my parliamentary region, but is of national importance to Scotland. So I don't know if that helps Bob Doris with his thinking, but I think hopefully we would all support what he's trying to do with this amendment. But I think Graeme Simpson is probably right for those who have to then do the reports and think about accountability. You know, they might be wondering what we mean in terms of regions and different localities of Scotland. But I think these issues can be overcome by Bob Doris.
I think, Monica Lennon, that's a very helpful intervention. Of course, it's very helpful to explain to anyone watching these proceedings about why we have a three-stage parliamentary process to iron out all of these things. That's an essential part of passing good legislation. In relation to the role of workers and unions, of course, the Just Transition Partnership that I spoke to ahead of lodging these two amendments have unions at its heart and at its core. And I pay tribute to them because they were keen not just to see workforce but also employers and obviously communities part of that just transition, so not just the workforce. Just briefly, convener, because the Minister made a reference, I think, in the previous grouping to Amendment 137, which does mention just transition. Now, it's quite concise, I have to say, Minister, in relation to that. But I get also what I'm trying to achieve here might be about the delivery of a just transition across the various sectors of the Scottish economy as opposed to within the strategy itself. I think I'm minded that there does have to be something on the face of the bill, Minister, that gives specific reference to what the policy intent would be of my amendment. I am open-minded as to the wording of that. I'm also open-minded as whether it best sits within the strategy section or perhaps elsewhere, but I think it is something that we do have to return to. So I'll kind of hold my position on this for the moment, convener. I'll listen with interest to what the minister says when she speaks to her own amendments. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Bob. I'm sure you do this on purpose, and I wasn't intending to make a declaration of interest, but as you mentioned agriculture, remind committee members that I'm involved in a farming partnership in Moray, so I am directly involved in agriculture. I thought it was going to be something I would have to make when we get to fly tipping, which is something that most farmers have suffered, but I make it now to be completely transparent, although I'm not going to take part in this debate. I'm going to call, though, Maurice Golden to speak to Amendment 210 and any other amendments in the group. Maurice.
Thanks, Convener. Just making some general points as a result of the debate and the amendments. I think that, firstly, replacing things with goods, products and materials is a useful one. I think it's important that just transition is embedded in the bill, and I think we should be having regard to global supply chains, but I also think we have to be confident, and the committee has to be confident, that where the amendment suggests such, we are able to monitor, audit those materials, and that's a general comment because I think we'll come to that again later on. Regarding incineration, I appreciate the Minister's comments on this. I think we need to be very cautious about the term a ban on a new incinerators. For example, last month a new incinerator opened in Aberdeen, which would suggest to me there's not a ban in that form on new incinerators. So I think my understanding as well from Colin Church's excellent report on the subject is that we will have, certainly from 27 onwards, an overcapacity on incinerators to the extent that it's highly unlikely that finance would be available and companies would be looking to construct and go through planning of a new incinerator. So it seems... Yes, happy to.
Member for taking an intervention. Would he concede that the new energy from waste plant in Aberdeen was actually, it may be opened recently, but it's been in the planning since 2016. And just on that, I'd like to declare an interest. I was a former councillor at Aberdeen City Council.
For that clarification, Douglas. Maurice.
Yeah, and if you look at the number of incinerators in planning throughout Scotland, then it's far exceeds what could potentially be required for Scotland, even if we miss a variety of targets. So I just gently point out that we need to be cautious around our language, and I appreciate the Minister's comments around incinerator, and indeed the application of the waste hierarchy, which again is a general theme throughout these amendments and throughout the amendments to the bill as a whole. Regarding 210, this is essentially to encourage the Scottish Government to ensure that we have a refillables promotion plan. Refillables are becoming increasingly common in the European Union, with some really interesting projects. I would like to see Scotland leading the way, and I think that having a refillables promotion plan would be really helpful, particularly and crucially for those smaller businesses that perhaps, or third sector organisations that might struggle developing an entire system around, in this case, refillables. And I think that's really important, and government could have a role in supporting them in terms of that.
Yeah, can I thank Maurice Golden for giving way? Could he just confirm, though, that this bill doesn't need new powers in order to develop refillables and refillable schemes in Scotland, because those powers are, as I understand it, within the Environment Act 2021? Is that right? So we don't actually need more legislation here, but I accept and you know, his desire to see more refillable schemes coming forward.
I might gently point out that we also don't need a circular economy strategy to be legislated on either, but that's a key part of the bill. The Scottish Government actually has already done that without legislation and could do so again. But we are where we are, and you can only play with what's in front of you, I suppose. And therefore, if we remove anything that isn't strictly required, then I would suggest there won't be much for us to talk about.
Happy to.
The member's talking about we don't need a circular economy strategy to get on with a circular economy strategy, but would the member accept that Parliament's moulding in statute what a circular economy strategy should actually look like, how it should be monitored, how it should be reported on, and it will actually structure a strategy where it will be the will of Parliament rather than the will of government. So actually putting on a statutory footing actually empowers Parliament. And can you just confirm, Mr. Golding, you'd actually support putting the strategy on a statutory footing?
Well, I think what's key here is that we've got a circular economy strategy defined in the legislation. I think that on that basis, and I thank Bob Dorris for supporting my amendment in terms of 210, which would be the logical conclusion of the argument that the refillables promotion plan could then be moulded by Parliament as well. So I think that's really useful. I've been waiting 8 years for this bill, so I'm delighted to be able to contribute to the circular economy strategy as a parliamentary process rather than a government process where I would just find out about it. So that's great news. My point was it isn't required to do a circular economy strategy via legislation, but I'm delighted to be part of that process.
Can I just intervene just slightly further? That was all really interesting stuff. Mr. Golden, I'd actually hear you say at any point, yes, you do support the strategy on a statutory footing. Perhaps it's my carelessness that I didn't actually hear that. Could you just confirm that?
Yes.
Thank you.
Can I just remind members, if they could try and not hold conversations between themselves and do it through me, I it would make life easier. Back to you, Mr. Golden, unless you've finished.
Thank you. The other amendments in the group are to ensure, as we've kind of touched on 133, that products are managed in line with the waste hierarchy and that the circular economy strategy must, where possible, ensure waste is managed locally. So, for example, just 2% of plastics collected for recycling in Scotland are recycled in Scotland. Now, it doesn't mandate that because it may not be possible to have a plastic recycling facility in Scotland. I would like to see one, but if it's not possible, then there we are. But that's an indication of where I was going on that. I think the circular economy strategy 137A must have regard to the desirability of goods, products and materials being managed as locally as possible in order and in doing so ensure that the prevention of harmful goods, products and materials are considered along with global just transition principles and due diligence in supply chains. 140, and I'll kind of link that to 122, I did have a look at naming specific sectors in the bill, and I felt that 140, by mirroring the climate change plan, actually provides the flexibility to have the relevant sectors as a result of that plan and as a result of the Climate Change Act. I think it becomes quite tricky when you deviate from that to highlight a specific sector, because as we've discussed earlier, sectors that are at the forefront now in terms of our thinking around circular economy may drop down the agenda. And indeed, in 122, for example, food waste is in part a subset of household waste, which is referenced. So I think construction is incredibly important, but I think you quickly go down a rabbit hole when you pick out one over another, especially given
technological advances, and that would be in the bill. But there is interesting work, which I think is really beneficial, in Ben McPherson's other amendment, which I think could be something that could be worked on to take forward in the bill, because it might be that we do want some sector-specific analysis, but I think it would be very helpful, again, for the Minister and the Scottish Government, perhaps, to provide us with the information around sector targeting, what might be achieved, what's possible, what's in the parameters of the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament to do in this area. But I am conscious of how important construction is and should be part of the circular economy. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Morris. I think, as Bob did for me and required me to make a declaration, Douglas has done for you, Jackie, and you feel the need to make a declaration as well. So, Jackie, over to you.
Yes, thank you, Convener. Just to declare my interest as another former Aberdeen City Councillor before I became an MSP.
Okay. And knew about the incineration plant.
Well, I was part of the process from the very start, from the energy from waste plant.
Perfect. Energy from waste. I've now got the name right. Minister, I'm now going to call you to speak on to Amendment 136 and any other amendments within the group.
Thank you, Convener. So I will speak first to the Scottish Government amendments. That's 136, 137, 138 and 139. Following the recommendations from this committee in Stage 1 report, the Scottish Government is bringing forward a number of amendments to strengthen the provisions in Section 1 of the Bill in relation to the Circular Economy Strategy. The committee has welcomed the principle of placing the strategy on a statutory basis and recommended, and I quote, it must focus action and resources on measures further up the waste hierarchy than is currently the case. So I agree that focusing the action high up the waste hierarchy is crucial. Amendment 136 ensures that in the preparation of the strategy, ministers must have regard to the waste hierarchy. The description of the waste hierarchy is set out in the amendment and derives from Article 4 of the Waste Framework Directive. And this amendment will ensure that ministers take into account the use of resources in the circular economy in line with that established framework of the waste hierarchy. Now, incineration has been mentioned by a number of people, initially by Sarah Boyack, and a few other people have spoken to it as well. Obviously, incineration is part of the waste hierarchy, but it is very at the lower end of the waste hierarchy as well. We also want to ensure that we keep alignment with the EU on that and refer to an established waste hierarchy that sectors are familiar with, already used and recognised. Yes.
I just wonder if the Scottish Government would consider rebanding different types of incineration. So you've got things like pyrolysis, which is currently, as defined by SEPA, in with incineration. You've also, as we know, energy from waste is different from a pure incinerator, for example. I just wonder if the Scottish Government would perhaps give consideration and work with SEPA in terms of delimiting the different types of incineration.
Certainly, I'll take your points away. I think it's a really interesting point, given that there's quite a lot of incineration plans that are actually involved in district heating as well. If you look at one of the oldest incineration waste energy plants in Shetland, it's actually used for municipal heating as well. So I think it's one of those things that we need to bear in mind, that it's not just a case of burning waste. It can also be a case of providing other advantages to communities as well. But I'll take that away, Mr. Golden. I also agree with the committee that just transition principles are relevant here too. Ensuring a just transition is central to the development of the circular economy. Forgive me if I don't agree with people who say that just transition is a buzzword. It is absolutely central. Yes. Yes.
Thank you, Minister. I think the point I was seeking to make, Minister, is it has to be more than just a phrase that people drop into conversation to say they're doing a just transition, and it shouldn't become buzzwords. It has to be a reality, which is the point of the amendments I've got here this morning also, Minister.
And I can assure Mr. Dorris that just transition is embedded throughout A lot of the government's thinking across portfolios as well, and I'll come on to that later. Ensuring a just transition is central to the development of a circular economy. Amendment 137 would ensure that the just transition principles as set out in 35C of the Climate Change Scotland Act 2009 are taken into account by ministers in the development of the circular economy strategy. The committee also emphasised the importance of behavioural change, and again, I agree with that view, so I'm proposing an additional requirement, Amendment 138, that in developing the circular economy strategy, Scottish ministers must have regard to the kinds of behavioural change needed to meet the strategy's objectives. And finally, the committee called for a clearer link on the face of the bill between the strategy and the targets. These are already linked by the criteria for the circular economy being repeated in the same terms in sections 1 and 6. But Amendment 139 would go further and put a specific obligation on ministers to have regard to the targets in preparing the strategy. Together, these amendments provide for the comprehensive and broad-reaching circular economy strategy that takes into account a range of relevant factors. And these amendments also impact on some of the amendments that have been lodged. I just want to make one point here on the have regard. And have regard effectively means in legislation take account of the principles in preparing the strategy. We think that's the appropriate level of compliance here. Can I talk to some of the other amendments that have been moved by other members? Several amendments refer to just transition principles. And as I've said, I agree that ensuring a just transition is central to the development of a circular economy. And that's why I've brought forward Amendment 137, to ensure that the just transition principles are taken into account in the development of the circular economy strategy. But more widely, our approach to just transition planning is guided by our just transition planning framework and the national just transition outcomes described in that. I would also like to provide reassurance that circular economy principles are therefore being considered as part of ongoing just transition planning work, particularly in relation to supporting economies, jobs, place and environmental incomes. But I would say that just transition is actually wider than that. It's also ensuring that people are not disadvantaged unnecessarily. And communities could also refer to people maybe in rural areas. It could refer to people who maybe have mobility issues as well. So we've always got to take into account maybe the unintended consequences of what we're doing for a good reason, but how they may impact on people. And I agree with Bob Doris's comments on that. For clarity, the government's committed to just transition plans for high emitting sectors, sites and regions. We began with our energy strategy and just transition plan, which is going to be published in the summer. We are also developing sectoral plans for agriculture and land use, the built environment and construction and transport. And I will be obviously taking them forward with my colleagues who have responsibility for those portfolio areas. And work is also well underway on the just transition plan for Grangemouth and the site plan for the Grangemouth industrial cluster. Amendment 93, I believe, would add unnecessary detail to the circular economy strategy. But if the government amendment 137 is accepted, Scottish ministers will have to have regard to just transition in the development of the strategy, and so it will already be considered within it. Amendments 98 and 99, I don't believe they're necessary given the proposed amendment in 137, which requires ministers to have regard to just transition principles in developing the strategy. Circular economy principles should be embedded across all sectors of the economy, and that's why they're already being considered as part of just transition policy. Requiring level of detail referred to in Amendments 208 and 209, I feel would be burdensome in the circular economy strategy and will be considered as part of the sector-specific plans already in development. For these reasons, Scottish Government cannot support Amendments 93, 98 and 99 from Sarah Boyack or Amendments 208 or 209 from Bob Doris. I'll move on to other amendments that have been mentioned. Amendment 132... Convener, I have to say that I agree with the principle and sentiment that Monica Lennon expresses here. The wider extraterrestrial territorial Did I say extraterrestrial? extraterritorial. Okay. And I realise why everyone's looking at me, bizarre, like I'm a bizarre person. The wider extraterritorial impact of material consumption is an important consideration. The Scottish Government is already required to annually publish carbon footprint statistics, which include embedded carbon from imported goods. And this also includes experimental statistics, which outline the embedded material requirements by country of origin in 2019. That was associated with final consumption in Scotland. Zero Waste Scotland also publishes material flows accounts, which consider imported goods. Monica Lennon also mentioned the impact of export waste to other countries, but I'm afraid that is reserved policy to the UK government. However, we need to be clear on what we can and what we can't influence. Obviously, with regards to exports, that's reserved to UK government. But obviously, the carbon footprint is based on broad trade and is heavily dependent on emissions from other countries over which Scotland has no control. But however, I would be happy to reflect on what we can reasonably and feasibly do ahead of stage three. I can't support the amendments as it stands, but we're going to take it away and have a look at what we can put in there that has the, I suppose, the recognition of the wider impacts that Monica Lennon mentions.
Yeah. Grateful to the Minister, and appreciate we've not had a chance to have a conversation about these amendments given recent changes. So I welcome the comments from the Minister today and hope there'll be an opportunity to meet with her and her officials ahead of stage three.
Yeah, obviously, given the changes in government responsibility, there's been very little time for me to have meetings with members. But of course, ahead of stage three, there is time to do that. So absolutely. Now, if I could turn to Amendment 181 and 213. While the principle of do no harm is a worthy aspiration, the principle as defined within Amendment 213 would be impossible for Scottish ministers to comply with in developing the circular economy strategy, given the global nature of trade and products and materials, identifying affected populations and all adverse consequences and alleviating them in other countries would simply not be possible. For those reasons, the Government cannot support Amendments 181 and 213 from Sarah Boyack. Moving on to talk about 182 and 186 around transition minerals. I'm grateful for Mr. Ruskell for raising this important issue of the resources required for the transition to a circular economy. Minerals, some of which are rare, are critical for that transition. And of course, materials involved in batteries and wind turbines has been mentioned by Mr. Ruskell, and obviously electric vehicles as well. Amendment 182 refers to transition minerals, and Amendment 186 provides a definition of those transition minerals, and they're often called critical minerals. However, I must argue against the inclusion of this requirement on the face of the bill. The bill needs to be future-proofed. What's critical for the energy sector in the 2020s may no longer be critical in the 2040s or 2050s. There's already a great deal of innovation happening, indeed, across the world, but even in Scotland, around the materials being used for batteries, for example. New technologies may have been developed that do not need the minerals or the improved processes for recycling or recovery of the minerals from existing uses, and have greatly increased the supply. For that reason, I'm afraid I cannot support Amendments 182 and 186. But I do agree it's an important issue. Zero Waste Scotland has published energy infrastructure materials mapping research, which outline material requirements up to 2050, including critical materials such as lithium. And this will be taken into account as part of ongoing policy development. Moving on, convener. Yes.
Thank you very much, Minister. I'm wondering then if the Minister feels that it's not appropriate to put something like this on the face of the bill, if there's another way for the Scottish Government to kind of work with industry and ensure that aspiration to deal with critical minerals in a way that is sustainable can be reflected elsewhere in policy, maybe the energy strategy, for example.
As I said, we're going to take what's been mentioned in the account in policy direction. Obviously, the energy strategy is reaching its final stages before it's published in the summer, but I'll certainly go away and have a look at what we have in there and what can maybe signpost stronger action in this area. Thank you. I move on to Amendment 210. I'm afraid the Scottish Government cannot support Amendment 210 from Maurice Golden. I fully support the premise that a system for refillables brings many benefits compared to single use. We'll all have refillables operations in our constituencies across Scotland, and they do a great job. A refillables plan is in line with our vision for a circular economy, but I don't consider it necessary to have such a requirement within the bill. Powers do exist in the Environment Act 2021 to make provisions in relation to producer responsibility, and these could be used to deliver refillables proposals. In addition, one purpose of the forthcoming reforms to packaging extended producer responsibility obligations is to encourage and further incentivise reuse and refill. And we'll also continue to work with the UK Government and other devolved governments, along with industry, to promote reuse of drinks containers. Reuse and refill will, of course, be central to the development of our circular economy strategy, however. I agree that any plans set out in the strategy should include measures designed to cut waste, challenge the current approach to production, promote sustainable choices and encourage reuse. And, of course, this can include plans for refillables, if appropriate. If Mr Golden would be happy not to press his amendment, I'd be happy to work with him to consider his proposals for refillables plans as part of our broader work in the circular economy and engagement with the UK Government and other devolved nations on this important topic. Moving to Amendments 94, 95, 96 and 97 from Sarah Boyack, I do agree that replacing the word things with goods, products and materials provides additional clarity to sections 1 and 6, and I'm happy to support these amendments.
Smiling on acceptance that things don't mean very much.
Thank you. And Amendment 183 from Mark Ruskell refers to giving priority to materials which are most harmful or polluting across the material's life cycle. And whilst these are worthy aims, the issue is they are difficult to define in law because some materials that are harmful are also necessary. For example, pesticides, certain chemicals which are controlled and managed through other regimes such as REACH. For this reason, I cannot support Amendment 183. Moving on to Amendments 133 and 184. Convener, the Scottish Government cannot support Amendment 133 from Maurice Golden or Amendment 184 from Sarah Boyack. I agree that having regard to waste, the waste hierarchy is crucial. I noted earlier that the description of the waste hierarchy is set out in Amendment 136 and derives from Article 4 of the Waste Framework Directive. This amendment will ensure that ministers take into account the use of resources in a circular economy in line with the established legal framework of the waste hierarchy. It also ensures consistent application of the waste hierarchy across waste-related legislation in Scotland. And for that reason, I cannot support Amendment 184 from Sarah Boyack and Amendment 133. I believe that 133 is unnecessary. My view is that in the interests of seeking continued EU alignment, we should continue to use the definition of waste hierarchy, which is enshrined in the EU Waste Framework Directive. Convener, Monica Lennon's amendments 134 and 185 introduced the concept of due diligence with regard to environmental protection and human rights. Due diligence with regard to procurement is important, and our national procurement legislation, the Procurement Reform Scotland Act 2014, has already established a national legislative framework for public procurement that supports sustainable economic growth by delivering economic, social, environmental benefits. The sustainable procurement duty in the Act requires contracting authorities to consider and act on opportunities to improve economic, social and environmental well-being. Contracting authorities with a procurement spend of £5 million or more in any financial year must set out in an organisational organisational procurement strategy, how they intend to comply with the sustainable procurement duty and their policy on the procurement of fair and ethically traded goods and services. They must also report on compliance with this strategy in their annual procurement reports. And in the interests of transparency, both procurement strategies and annual procurement reports must be published. In addition, a significant body of rights derived from the European Convention on Human Rights is already hardwired into the devolution settlement. In fact, it's already unlawful for Scottish public authorities to act in a way that is incompatible with those rights. Further rights, in particular, economic, social, cultural and environmental rights and non-discrimination, will be the subject of a future Scottish Human Rights Bill. I recognise that reflecting these duties in the circular economy strategy may be helpful and acknowledge the value of an approach which is founded in a commitment to the ongoing improvement and enhancement of due diligence processes. Whilst I can't support these amendments for the reasons set out, I'm happy again to work with the member ahead of stage three to establish what we can do, what more we can do to usefully embed them in existing frameworks. I'll move on to amendment 135 from Maurice Golden. I'm afraid I cannot support this. While a circular economy provides significant opportunities for communities, for example, in repair and reuse, it's not always the case due to logisticals or economic realities that all waste material should be treated as locally as possible. For example, there are many island communities, so for this reason, I cannot support the amendment, although I take his points on board about having more repair and reuse more in Scotland in general. Similarly, Amendment 137A from Maurice Golden refers to the desirability of goods, products and materials being managed as locally as possible, which will not always be viable logistically or economically. And the amendment also refers to prevention of harmful goods, products and materials. But as I said, in relation to Amendment 183, some goods, products and materials that could be classified as harmful are also necessary and are managed under other regimes like REACH. Amendment 137A also refers to just transition and due diligence, which I've already spoken to, and for these reasons I cannot support Amendment 137A. I'll come to Amendment 211. It refers to Scottish ministers having regard to safety considerations that may arise as a result of the circular economy, including electrical safety considerations. Health and safety are clearly valid concerns, but they're subject to their own regimes, meaning it's unnecessary to provide such detail within the strategy. And I cannot support Amendment 211 from Claire Adamson, but I know she's not spoken to it already.
She hasn't, she will.
Okay. So apologies there to Claire Adamson, but again, she knows those regimes very well that exist across the whole of the UK.
Just to clarify, Claire Adamson could intervene if she wants to by indicating she wants to in the normal way, and I can bring her in, but she is going to be speaking next. I just don't want to stifle debate. So, Claire, if you're happy with that, I'll let the Minister continue. Thank you. Minister, sorry.
Thank you. Amendment 140, convener. The Scottish Government cannot support Amendment 140 from Maurice Golden. Section 5, page 2 of the bill already requires that circular economy strategy must be prepared with a view to achieving consistency with the objectives and plans set out in the climate change plan. So this amendment refers to the sectors which must already specifically be included in the climate change plan is unnecessary. Now on to amendments 122 and 123. These are from Ben McPherson, and I agree that construction and food waste and household waste would necessarily be considered and prioritised as part of the development of the first circular economy strategy. These are all priorities within the draft circular economy roadmap, and so will be considered in the development of the strategy. The roadmap has a specific focus on reducing food and construction waste, as you would expect, given that they are at the top of the issues that we have with waste more generally. Construction is a sector within our climate change plan and is central to our forthcoming consultation on delivering a just transition for the built environment, which will include consideration of the circular economy. The approach in section 1, page 4, is that Scottish ministers must have particular regard to sectors and systems most likely to contribute to developing a circular economy strategy, rather than specifying particular sectors and systems. And this will allow future strategies the flexibility to focus on the most relevant sectors and systems of the time. This would be informed by relevant research and engagement. Including specific sectors on the face of the bill would limit that flexibility. And I actually agree with Maurice Golden, who also made this point as well. So I cannot accept amendments 122 and 123 from Ben McPherson, but I would be happy to consider further ahead of stage 3 what we consider in this area, for example, around criteria for identifying sectors rather than naming the sectors themselves on the face of the bill. Product stewardship is the substance of Amendment 212 from Sarah Boyack, and we recognise the importance of this topic, and that's why we're already committed to creating a product stewardship strategy as set out within the draft circular economy roadmap. Our proposed product stewardship plan, due to be developed and published by 2025-26, will include at least 3 priority products for which a range of product stewardship measures will be identified alongside clear delivery timelines. And for each product, we will consider both the action we can take in Scotland under devolved powers and our expectations of the UK government, where effective action relies on reserve powers. And as set out in our draft roadmap, an approach to determining the products themselves and the measures taken must be decided on the basis of a robust, evidence-based approach, selecting the right strategy for the right products. Approving this amendment would preempt that thorough research, which will evidence the most effective measures for driving that stewardship. We recognise the need for a strategic approach to product stewardship across the waste hierarchy, from production and consumption through to recycling and end-of-life management. We also welcome these suggestions for measures to consider as part of the product stewardship design process. And while it not be appropriate to commit to them legislatively at this stage, we consider these measures are part of that ongoing work to develop that stewardship plan. I'd be extremely happy to work with the MSPs who will develop their product stewardship strategy as part of our broader work on the circular economy. I think that deals with all the amendments in this group. Convener.
Thank you very much, Minister. And now is Claire Adamson's time to speak to Amendment 211 and the other amendments in the group. Good morning, Claire.
Good morning, and thank you very much, Convener. Good morning, Minister. I will limit my comments to the probing Amendment 211 in my name. And the Minister has alluded to my long-term interest in all things safety, so I've brought this amendment in the hope that the regard for safety concern can be embedded in the Circular Economy Bill in order to inform consumer and household behaviour in regards particularly electrical product use and the safe disposal. I absolutely firmly believe that consumer behaviour will be key to the success of this bill and its intentions going forward. Consumer awareness is a long-term concern of stakeholders such as trading standards officers, Scottish Fire and Rescue, and the charity Electrical Safety First, who have worked with on this amendment. 72% of all house fires in Scotland have an element of electrical safety, with the majority of these caused by electrical products. So the bill sets out principles of things be kept in use for as long as possible and allows for target setting for the reuse of products. But this is a potential problem in that older and potentially unsafe products could be used by consumers, that repairs of electrical products being undertaken by unqualified people or using parts that may be sourced from online marketplaces, an unregulated marketplace, introducing danger to the products. And we have a long-term concern about the safety of second-hand electrical products. And it's well understood and well documented there is limited consumer awareness regarding the necessity for electrical products to be registered with the product manufacturer in order for potential safety recalls to be communicated to consumer. With regards to household waste and the imposing of duties on households and the target setting for local authorities, this could present an opportunity to address the issues emerging through the disposal of lithium iron batteries, which are a significant cause of fires in recent times. The proliferation of e-bikes and e-scooters has shown an increase in the fires from these particular items, but lithium ion batteries appear in most rechargeable products from electrical toothbrushes to rechargeable vapes. And it's really important that on the face, if we could have consideration for this somewhere within the bill to ensure products are safe and that consumers are kept safe going forward. And we have just recently seen the impact of major fires caused by lithium batteries, thermal runaway in some of our waste disposal areas. And it causes extreme disruption and it causes environmental damage. So if it's helpful, convener, at this stage, I heard the Minister's comments on this. It was a probing amendment. So at this stage, I will not be pressing it, but I would like possibly the opportunity for the Minister to make comment on what I have had a chance to say now. Thank you very much.
We'll come to whether you press or move it later, but thank you for that indication. I come to the Deputy Convener, Ben McPherson, to speak to amendment 122, and any other amendments in the group? Ben.
Thank you, Convener. In speaking to my amendments 122 and 123, I first want to thank Built Environment Forum Scotland, the Royal Institute of Chartered Surveyors in Scotland and the Chartered Institute of Building in Scotland for their engagement on these amendments and their collaboration. I also want to thank the Minister for engagement on the issues raised in these amendments and for her comments earlier. And also the previous Minister, Lorna Slater, MSP, and previous Special Advisor, Harry Hooton, and I acknowledge their important work on this bill. Thank colleagues for their comments also in moving their amendments on 122 and 123. During the process of our Stage 1 evidence, we heard a number of contributions emphasising the extent of construction on waste in Scotland. Indeed, some stakeholders stated that around 50% of the waste in the Scottish economy comes from construction. And therefore, I thought it was important to give consideration to whether construction, being such a large contributor of waste in the Scottish economy, should be on the face of the bill. I thought of this in particular considering that other specifics are on the face of the bill, including single-use items, household waste, and littering from vehicles, all of which contribute less in terms of waste when it comes to Scotland's quantum of waste across the board. However, I have listened carefully to what the Minister has said and what Mr. Golden has said about how we need to think about whether we want to list specific areas on the face of the bill. In terms of stating construction work, construction and demolition waste, food waste and household waste in Amendment 122, and considering the definitions in 123, all of which come from the Code of Practice for Managing Cold Waste, which is linked to the Environmental Protection Act 1990, I sought to cite not only the construction industry as defined in current regulation and law, but also to cite food waste as an area of priority that was raised during our Stage 1 evidence, and household waste as that is something that is already mentioned in the bill in other sections. However, I take the point about not wanting to be specific at this stage in listing particular sectors for inclusion in the strategy at on the face of the bill at this juncture. However, I would ask the Minister to continue to consider, and colleagues, into stage three. Yes.
Thank you for taking the intervention. I very much take the point that we heard during the committee the importance of construction waste and food waste, and I understand the point that Maurice Golden's made about listing items. I personally wonder if there is a way for the Minister to work with you to come up with finding a way to define those particular items, because they seem to be something that have been brought to us throughout the stage, and whether you'd be prepared to work with the Minister if the Minister gave you an insurance to try and find a way of including them.
I'm absolutely open and enthusiastic about working with the Minister into stage three, and also with colleagues across the Parliament as we continue to consider the areas of most of highest contribution to waste in Scotland. Yes.
Yeah. Thank the member for taking intervention. It's just, if it's not going to be on the face of the bill, I'm trying to think what else it could be. So do you think it could maybe be its own waste strategy around the construction industry? Or how do you think it, if it's not on the bill, how do you think it might be handled?
I think the points that have been made by colleagues and the Minister around maintaining flexibility are important. But I also do think that in the current times and for the years ahead, construction will need to be a main area of focus if this bill is to have practical meaning and to make the difference that is envisaged. Therefore, I was pleased to hear the Minister's comments around the route map, and I'm also going to be pleased to hear comments from Bob Dorris, who wants to come in.
The Deputy Convener for giving way. Ben McPherson's right to identify the demands there's going to be in construction and how it manages waste and all the evidence we took during our stage one evidence sessions. But just in relation to balance, would Ben McPherson agree with me? Construction is also a key contributor to net zero, because the better the construction standards, the better the energy standards, the better good quality new build homes we have in this country, not just in terms of where we stay, but in office buildings and retrofitting. Construction is a key sector to manage us towards net zero and to tackle our climate challenges. They're a key partner.
I would absolutely agree with Mr. Dorris's comments, and I would add to them that if we can move to a position where in the construction industry, whether it's at the large scale end of house building, if we can reduce waste point in the construction process, all the way to when, for example, somebody refits a bathroom or a kitchen, how much reuse is there of those materials? There's a whole scale approach that's needed to enable the construction industry and those working in it to make an even more significant contribution to the net zero journey. So I think we've had an important debate on these issues today. I've noted the points of the Minister, and I would urge colleagues, including the government, to think further ahead of stage three as to the importance of construction in this process and in this legislation having impact, and how much we may want to make more reference to construction. Whether that's on the face of the bill or not, we will continue that process of consideration together.
Thank you very much. I'm just looking around to see if anyone else wants to contribute to this section. I'm looking specifically at the Minister before I move to Sarah Boyatt, because there are two questions there raised by Claire and Ben, and I wondered if you wanted to respond to them before we move to Sarah Boyatt.
So, response to Claire Adamson, I recognise, as I always do, Claire Adamson's long-standing work on health and safety. She obviously will know that health and safety is reserved, and all electrical items should comply with that legislation. She makes mention of the handling of materials used in electrical items, you know, as part of the circular economy strategy. I can assure her that safety concerns will be referred to in the strategy, of course, but will also be making reference to quite a lot of reserved areas and what's expected on those items as well. But I think it's an important discussion to have. To give Ben McPherson a little bit even more assurance, construction will be prioritised in the waste route map for obvious reasons. Construction is still one of the areas of which waste is a real concern. But there will be, again, as I say, a specific just transition plan associated with the built environment in which the circular economy and the waste associated with that sector will be mentioned as well in great detail. It is also taken account in the forthcoming climate change plans as well. I think it's important that Ben McPherson did raise the fact that construction is still a sector in which we have to have some serious action in order to reduce the waste associated with it. So thank you. Yeah.
I think perhaps what the Minister is sensing is that across the committee there are concerns that, you know, despite sectors previously being identified as really important for action, such as construction a number of years ago, we haven't seen the follow through into waste route maps, into programmes of work from government. So perhaps she's sensing a sense of frustration across the committee that this is an area of significant resource use, significant impact in terms of climate change, but there's perhaps a concern that the government as a whole has not moved effectively to prioritise this. So I think clearly there's discussion between now and stage three around what action looks like from government, the whole of government, and what reassurances that the government can give this committee on a cross-party basis that action will follow. And I recognise the Minister is very, very new in post into this area.
The bill is one thing, but it's the strategy and the development and the strategy after that is really going to be the meat on the bones of that. But I totally appreciate that there's not been enough movement as there could be, or else we wouldn't have the statistics associated with the construction industry that we do.
Thank you, Minister. There are a few other members want to contribute. Graham Simpson first, followed by Douglas Lumsden.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Just very briefly, I just want to focus on Claire Adamson's Amendment 211. And I've listened to the arguments very carefully. I wasn't really sure about the amendment, particularly when listening to the Minister, but when Claire Adamson spoke, she persuaded me. She had a very, very powerful argument as to why this amendment should go forward. I know she says she's not going to press. I would urge her to press because I think I would like to know what the view of the committee would be if they were listening to Claire Adamson. I think they would have to have been persuaded by what she said. And similarly to Ben McPherson, if he feels confident that the Minister's assurance for stage three is strong enough, then fine. But, you know, he also makes a very strong argument and he could also press. But if he's assured by what the Minister says, then don't. But I would strongly urge Claire Adamson to press her amendment. Thank you.
Thank you. Douglas Lumsden.
I just wanted to make a couple of points, Convener. One was around construction as well, because we have heard during the whole evidence sessions that, you know, the amount of waste coming from the construction industry is huge, and if we can, you know, if we can make an impact on the construction industry waste, I think we're probably going to make huge steps in our waste overall. But, you know, I understand, maybe not on the face of the bill, because as Maurice Golden says, you know, some of our biggest polluters will change, and that's maybe to have flexibility not to have that on there, but be like to know what's going to sort of come from that, of course.
I was being disciplined earlier on because everyone wanted to talk about construction, and I've declared my hand as the convener of the cross-party group. But does Douglas accept and agree that there's actually a lot of innovation and good practice happening across construction already, and many in the industry would probably welcome being included in the strategy because there's some good practice to share there, and because there's a feeling of perhaps disconnect and not being listened to by everyone across government, that some of that good practice isn't really being shared and learned from. So it's not about, you know, having a go at sectors, it's about bringing them in and having them at the table. So is there a danger we might lose some of that opportunity if we don't have these sectors referenced in the strategy?
Yeah, no, I absolutely, and I apologise to the construction industry if it sounded like I'm myself demonising them. And I guess that was part of my question to Ben McPherson about, if it's not going to be on the bill, then what else could it be? It could be a strategy that's looking at best practice that they are all feeding into, and maybe that would be the best way forward. Well, I also want to speak about Claire Adamson's amendment, you know, raising real safety concerns. You know, we think that we should be reusing maybe like tools, for example, electrical tools, as much as possible, but I guess we need to do it in a very careful and considered way. Claire also had mentioned about lithium batteries for household goods. You know, that is a big concern, especially when they end up in a recycling centre, and my colleague Jackie Dunbar knows all too well what happens when, you know, there's a real fire risk around that. And I guess it's not just lithium batteries for household goods. We're seeing more batteries in terms of energy storage as well. So I think that will be a problem going forward. So I think it's been a really good amendment that Claire Adamson has brought forward today. A couple of other things I want to mention. Bob Doris's 208 and 209. I think it's right that we look at the impact of the plans, and we need to make sure that there's no unintended consequences. If we look at agriculture, for example, we need to make sure there's no areas that are unduly impacted by that. Sarah Boyack's 212, I completely agree with the intention of that amendment, but I do have real concerns about the Internal Market Act that I'm sure we'll have lots of discussions in the weeks ahead around this bill. And, you know, some suppliers are doing great work around, you know, take back already, and I would be concerned that this may undermine some of that. You know, I could be wrong. And I agree with the Minister on I was going to say extraterritorial principles from Monica Lennon. Once again, I agree with the intention, but, you know, to make this bill meaningful, I think we've got to make sure that we can monitor it, we can measure it correctly, and I think it would be difficult to see, but, you know, if Monica was going to take this away, and, you know, I'd support it in the future, but if she can put my fears at rest on that one, and I'll just leave it there, Camilla.
Okay, thank you. I'm now going to call on Sarah Boyack to wind up and press or withdraw Amendment 93. Sarah.
Thank you, Convener. Bit of a pressure. I think this is really, really good, the range of amendments that colleagues have moved, because there's a clear appetite, having taken evidence in your committee, to actually strengthen this bill and make sure it delivers in a way that it can and actually must do. Delighted that the Minister is happy to accept my removal of things and inclusion of goods, products and materials. I think that's really constructive and hopefully does strengthen the bill. My sections on the Just Transition Partnership, there's clearly competition across all of us. I'm keen to push mine because I crafted my Just Transition Partnership in light of what I think the Just Transition Partnership team were after, but it's up to the committee to decide whose preference you've got. I also want to add to the register of interests for this team today and say that I have a voluntary register of interest on my parliamentary website in relation to Friends of the Earth Scotland. Long-term commitment there. Amendment 184 on the European Waste Directive, I'm going to have a look at that in relation to stage three. I'm very committed to this issue, but I'll reflect on what colleagues have said. I think there's been a really good debate, and I think what really strikes me is the appetite for getting action here, whether it's Maurice Golden's link to the climate change plan, which we don't have yet. So that's a really big gap in terms of action. There's the refillables promotion plan. That's all about awareness, but also linking into companies, deliverability, again, day-to-day issues. How do we ramp up? Monica Lennon's amendments about human rights and procurement. You know, the procurement bill, as somebody commented on, was 2014. So there's a gap between ambition and delivery. And the Rana Plaza, you know, if you remember, those of us who are privileged to be here in 2013, that was a horrendous experience. It's over a decade ago now. And if you look at the companies that bought materials from the companies producing at Rana Plaza, they are some of the most well-known, fashionable supply chains for our clothes. So there's a gap between ambition and intention. And the fast fashion movement has massively moved ahead for those of us who are interested. But I wonder how aware people who buy those clothes from producers like that are really aware of the terms and conditions, the costs, and the import issue for us, you know, as Britain and Scotland have moved out of supplying fashion. There's a real global question in there that we need to address. There's been quite a strong support for Claire Adamson's electrical safety issue being on the face of the bill. Again, this is about making this something that we're aware of and about how do you strategically get that action in place, because there are more fires happening and examples have been given in terms of waste products, but there's also something about supply of products that are not good enough. And I'm thinking of the discussions we've had in the sustainable transport team that Graham chairs. If you think about e-bikes, there's people going under the radar here and it's not safe, so it has to be higher up the agenda. One of the things... very briefly, yeah.
Yeah, but, I mean, it's just on that point, and this is the point that Claire Adamson made so powerfully and why she should press her amendment, or if she doesn't, somebody else should, that in relation to e-bikes, you know, we've got to do better on you know, what we do with the batteries on these bikes, what we do in the second-hand market. It's not just about fire safety, that's very important, but there is this question of, you know, how do you reuse products? And I just think that, yeah, I can't say it strongly enough that Claire Adamson really should press this amendment. I know she's probably not going to, but somebody else should, because it's so important.
Can I just say intervention should be on a question rather than a statement, Mr. Simpson? So I'm sure your question was did Sarah Boyack agree with you? So, Sarah, back to you.
Thank you for that. Strategic intervention, convener. Yes, and I think the point here is that lower standards are cheaper goods. But whether it's fashion or electrical goods, that's not good in a number of ways. So I think that's a well-made question, Graham. And also Monica.
I'm loving Graham Simpson's enthusiasm for Claire Adamson's amendment, and also recognise Claire's long-standing work around health and safety matters. We didn't find out if our deputy convener managed to get his iron repaired. That was a feature of the stage one debate. You'll all be glad I've reminded you of that. But I think there is a really important link between, you know, repair and safety and just transition, because if we're going to get this right in terms of repair and reuse and so on, then it's a big skills issue. We need to give certainty to employers. Yeah, I will do in a moment. But we need to give certainty to employers around training and all the sort of requirements and investment around that. So, does Sarah Boyack agree that there is a lot of merit in Claire Adamson's amendment, and would all be keen to see whether it's pressed today or not, that we further this conversation for stage three? But I think Ben now wants to... I don't know the etiquette. Do I go to Sarah first? The convener's busy. Ben, I'll bring you in.
What a wonderful allegation. I'm not busy. I'm trying to work out how far interventions go in the winding up speeches and how much longer Sarah's got to go. I'm just conscious that we're under a lot of pressure, but I will allow Ben to come in if because I think you intimated you wanted to. Ben, do you want to?
I thank Sarah Boyack for taking the intervention. I just to add to Monica Lennon's points about skills, would colleagues also agree with me that having the necessary infrastructure, as in places for people to go to engage with the circular economy, is very important? And of course, there will be consideration of that around Amendment 128 in due course.
Absolutely. A very important intervention by the Deputy Convener there. Skills are critical for delivering a circular economy because we are going to need those skills in every single community across Scotland, in every local authority across Scotland. And I'm sure we'll come back to that issue about how do we actually deliver this later, but that's a very important point of intervention. The other point I was going to move on to was the amendments by Ben yourself about the issues that were raised at stage one by Ben McPherson on the whole issue of construction, which I totally agreed with, and I think this needs to be ramped up. The committee recognised that in your report about the extensiveness of construction material waste. So there's something about working with businesses. There's also something about prioritising investment in existing buildings and the nature of the materials used for that, because that's way more efficient than demolition and then starting from scratch. So I think there's issues that go back to town centre renewal there as the world changes at a rate of knots in terms of digital relationships and retail. So I thought those issues were very important, and I hope if Ben is going to negotiate with the Minister that we don't lose this from the face of the bill, because I think the construction amendments are critical. If I can comment on Mark Ruskell's amendments, I thought they were really important in terms of transition materials, and it goes back almost to the discussion we had there about e-bikes, about batteries, about renewables. These are all critical materials, and technology is moving at pace, but the point the Minister made about it, we could be thinking about this for 2040s and 50s, it's actually a now issue, and we need to be influencing in a constructive way the producers so that we get more efficient, safe products that we can all buy. And that's absolutely critical in relation to the use of minerals. We need to be questioning them, and I would much prefer this to be on the face of the bill, given it's such an important issue that goes back again to human rights and production. I think there have been several references to other pieces of legislation: the Climate Change Act 2021, the Procurement Act 2014, and the Climate Change Act 2019 and the Environmental Act 2021. I think what's common in all those references is that we are not making fast enough progress, and this bit of legislation is critical to our economy, to our environment, and to our communities. And we'll come on to local authorities later, but I just want to finish on the point. This is our opportunity to actually deliver. So I hope if members don't move amendments today, we can come back to them in advance of stage three. I think there's been a welcome offer by that in terms of the Minister. There will be a queue at your door. This is a really important issue. I will be moving amendment 93. I will not be withdrawing it in my name. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. And just before we go any further, just to clarify, and it was what I was trying to do when Monica said I was otherwise engaged, what I was just clarifying in my brain is, and with the clerks, is Rule 9.10.14, which that if amendment is not moved by a member present, any other member present at the committee, not committee members, any other member present here at the meeting today, can actually move the amendment. So the procedure would be, I would ask if the member's going to move it, and if the member says not moved, I will then say not moved, and that is the opportunity, if anyone then wants to amend it, to do so. So I wanted to clarify that, but Sarah Boyack has pressed Amendment 93, so the question that we come to is Amendment 93 agreed? We are not agreed, therefore there will be a division. Those in favour, please raise their hands. Those against, please raise their hands. And there are no abstentions. So there are three votes for, four against, therefore it is not agreed. I therefore call Amendment 132 in the name of Monica Lennon, already debated with Amendment 93. Monica Lennon to move or not move?
Not moved.
The amendment is not moved. Therefore, I call Amendment 181 in the name of Sarah Boyack, already debated with Amendment 93. Sarah Boyack to move or not move?
Not moved.
Amendment is not moved. I therefore call Amendment 182 in the name of Mark Ruskell, already debated with Amendment 93. Well, a procedure would be that Mark Ruskell to move or not move. It's not moved. I therefore call Amendment 208 in the name of Bob Dorris, already debated with Amendment 93. Bob Dorris to move or not moved?
Not moved.
OK, the amendment is not moved. I call Amendment 209 in the name of Bob Dorris, already debated with Amendment 93. Bob Dorris to move or not move?
Not moved.
The amendment is not moved. I therefore call Amendment 210 in the name of Maurice Golden, already debated with Amendment 93. Maurice Golden to move or not moved?
Not moved.
Not moved. I therefore call Amendment 94 in the name of Sarah Boyack, already debated with Amendment 93. Sarah Boyack to move or not move?
Moved, convener.
The amendment is moved. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Therefore, I call Amendment 183 in the name of Mark Ruskell, already debated with Amendment 93. Mark Ruskell moved. To move or not moved?
Not moved.
The amendment is not moved. I therefore call Amendment 95 in the name of Sarah Boyack, already debated with Amendment 93. Sarah Boyack to move or not moved?
Moved, convener.
Moved. So the question is Amendment 95 agreed? Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I therefore call Amendment 95 in the name of Sarah Boyack, already debated with Amendment 93. Sorry? Okay. That's what happens when you follow a script. I apologise. So I call Amendment 96 in the name of Sarah Boyack, already debated with Amendment 93. Sarah Boyack to move or not move?
Moved, convener.
The amendment is moved. The question is that Amendment 96 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Therefore, I call Amendment 97 in the name of Sarah Boyack, already debated with Amendment 93. Sarah Boyack to move or not moved?
Moved, convener.
Thank you. The question is Amendment 97 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Therefore, I call Amendment 133 in the name of Maurice Golden, already debated with Amendment 93. Maurice Golden to move or not moved?
Moved.
The amendment is moved. Therefore, the question is Amendment 133 agreed? Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour, please raise your hands. Thank you. Those against? Thank you. There are three votes for, four votes against. Therefore, the amendment is not agreed. I therefore call Amendment 98 in the name of Sarah Boyack, already debated with Amendment 93. Sarah Boyack, to move or not moved?
Moved, convener.
The amendment is not moved. I therefore call Amendment 134 in the name of Monica Lennon, already debated with Amendment 93. Monica Lennon, to move or not moved?
Not moved.
The amendment is not moved. I therefore call Amendment 135 in the name of Maurice Golden, already debated with Amendment 93. Maurice Golden, to move or not moved?
Moved.
The amendment is moved. The question, therefore, is Amendment 135 be agreed? Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour, please raise their hands. Thank you. Those against, please raise their hands. Thank you. The result of the amendment is there are three votes for, four votes against. Therefore, the amendment is not agreed. I therefore call Amendment 184 in the name of Sarah Boyack, already debated with Amendment 93. Sarah Boyack to move or not moved?
Not moved.
The amendment is not moved. The call Amendment 185 in the name of Monica Lennon, already debated with Amendment 93. Monica Lennon to move or not move?
Not moved.
Amendment is not moved. I therefore call Amendment 136 in the name of Lorna Slater, already debated with Amendment 93. Minister to move formally, please.
Moved.
Thank you. The question therefore is Amendment 136 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed.
No.
Oh, sorry, we are not agreed. Sorry, I apologise, Monica, I didn't hear you. Therefore, there will be a division. Those in favour, please raise their hands. Thank you. Those against, please raise their hands. And those who wish to abstain, please raise their hands. Thank you. So there are 6 votes for, no votes against, and 1 abstention. Therefore, the amendment is agreed. Therefore, I call amendment 137 in the name of Lorna Slater, already debated with amendment 93. Minister, to move formally. The amendment is moved. I therefore call amendment 137A in the name of Maurice Golden, already debated with amendment 93. Maurice Golden, to move or not moved?
Moved.
The question, therefore, at this stage is that amendment 137A be agreed. Are we all agreed? Yes. We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour, please raise their hands. Those against, please raise their hands. And those who wish to abstain, please raise their hands. So there are two votes for, there are 4 votes against, there's 1 abstention. Therefore, the amendment is not agreed. Minister, to press or withdraw amendment... Oh, no, you don't. Because we didn't amend it, so that's very simple, sorry. I'm a bit rusty at this since the last session, I apologise. The question is that amendment 137 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
No, we are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour, please raise their hands. Those against, please raise their hands. Those who wish to abstain, raise their hands. The result of the division is there are 6 votes for, no votes against, and 1 abstention. The amendment, therefore, is agreed. I call amendment 138 in the name of Lorna Slater, already debated with amendment 93. Minister, to move formally, please.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is amendment 138 be agreed. Are we all agreed? Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Thank you. The question, therefore, now... Sorry, I call amendment 139 in the name of Lorna Slater, already debated with amendment 93. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that amendment 139 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I therefore call amendment 211 in the name of Claire Adamson, already debated with amendment 93. Claire Adamson, to move or not moved?
Not moved, convener.
Not moved. Sorry, Douglas, I didn't hear that.
Can I move, convener?
Douglas Lumsden wants to move that amendment. So the question is, we will come to a question, is that amendment 211 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yeah.
We're not agreed. Those in favour, please raise their hands. Thank you. Those against, please raise their hands. And there are no abstentions. Therefore, it's 3 votes for, 4 votes against. Therefore, the amendment is not agreed. I call amendment 140 in the name of Maurice Golden, already debated with amendment 93. I remind members that if amendment 140 is agreed to, I cannot call amendment 122 because of right of preemption. Preemption. Maurice Golden, to move or not moved?
Moved.
Moved. The question is that amendment 140 be agreed. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour, please raise their hands. Those against, please raise their hands. And there are no abstentions. So that's 3 votes for, 4 votes against. Therefore, the amendment is not agreed. So I now call amendment 122. In the name of Ben McPherson, already debated with amendment 93. Ben McPherson, to move or not moved?
Considering what the Minister said, and in order to enable further consideration ahead of stage 3, not moved.
The amendment is not moved. Therefore, I call amendment 212 in the name of Sarah Boyack, already debated with amendment 93. Sarah Boyack, to move or not moved?
Not moved, convener.
Thank you. The amendment is not moved. Call amendment 99 in the name of Sarah Boyack, already debated with amendment 93. Sarah Boyack, to move or not moved?
Not moved, convener, but I would like to discuss with the minister in advance of stage three.
Okay, now, I know the question, I'm just being very careful. I don't want to open up debates again at this stage. So I'm going to move to amendment 123 in the name of Ben McPherson, already debated with amendment 93. Ben McPherson to move or not move?
Not move.
Thank you. The amendment's not moved. I call amendment 186 in the name of Mark Ruskell, already debated with amendment 93. Mark Ruskell to move or not move?
Not moved.
Yeah, not moved. I therefore call amendment 213 in the name of Sarah Byack, already debated with amendment 93. Sarah Byack to move or not move?
Not moved.
And the amendment is not moved. The question at this stage is that section 1 be agreed. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Let's listen to one for a pause. Considering the time it's taken to get through that group of amendments, I think it would be appropriate to have a 9-minute pause, so we'll be back here at 11:15. Thank you very much. I suspend the meeting. Okay, welcome back to this session on the stage two of the Circular Economy Bill. I'm going to call Amendment 1 in the name of Maurice Golden Group with Amendments 187, 188, 23, 189, 80 and 90. Maurice Golden to move Amendment 1 and speak to all amendments in the group. Maurice.
Thanks, Convener. Happy to move Amendment 1, which requests that there's co-design of all aspects of the circular economy strategy with the public sector, private sector and third sector bodies. And I think that collaborative approach and indeed co-design approach is something that's broadly the intention of the Scottish Government and has been deployed, for example, or intends to be deployed with working with local authorities. 190 gently pushes SEPA to ensure that any waste guidance published by them is done so in accordance with the circular economy strategy. And what that is trying to do is ensure that things such as the definition of waste, end of life, end of waste and duty of care are constantly considered and updated in the context of the circular economy. Because as the committee will be aware, once something enters into the, is defined as waste and enters into waste legislation, there's particular practices that have to be done. And actually an intention of both the circular economy and this bill is to keep, for example, whether it be materials or products or goods, not things, in circulation for as long as possible. So actually by reusing an item, whether that be through resale or sharing, then that would not enter the waste legislation. And that's, while it's quite a gentle nudge, it's just something to really nod to SEPA that as a committee and indeed a parliament, we would like them to have the circular economy in their minds when they're regulating the environment. And I think overall in this group, I think this is a very positive section. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I now call on Bob Dorris to speak to Amendment 187 and any other amendments in the group. And Bob, you want to clarify something which I'm happy for you to put on the record.
Yes, Convener, I meant to do it at the start of the session. There's huge time constraints upon us. There'll be lots of times where members will withdraw or not press amendments, but on the basis we'll engage with the Minister ahead of stage three. But rather than say that every single time, members, I think that can be inferred that is a set process for many within the passage of the bill. I get that amendments are within the gift of the presiding officer when we return to stage three, but I just wanted to put that on the record.
For to put it on the record and so members don't need to say every time whether they choose not to move an amendment. That it's absolutely their right to engage with the Minister and also to bring an amendment to stage three, which is beyond my scope to say whether they can be accepted, you rightly say. But, on that point, yes.
Thank you, Convener, and I think Bob Dorris is trying to be helpful as ever. I think it's also worth acknowledging we're in quite an unusual situation where we've had a change in Minister, which can happen. And the Minister today has explained that she's had very little time to engage directly with the members of the committee, but also many other members who have a big interest in this bill. Because when we look at the stage one evidence and report, we can see there's many, many stakeholders and people across Scotland have engaged with this. So it's also been mindful that many of us have had conversations with ministers and officials. There's been a change and it's about getting as much assurance today that there will be time made available so that not just the members of the committee, but other members with amendments have that time to engage meaningfully with government. I think that's what the minister has been hinting at today, but I think that is something that we probably all want further reassurance on.
And I see the Minister nodding, so we can perhaps leave it at that, that the Minister is happy to engage. But the committee did give the government extra time to engage, but there wasn't a huge amount of extra time, so there will be extra work required, and I'm sure the Minister, by nodding then, was inferring that she's happy to do that. So I'm going to move back to Bob Doris to speak to Amendment 187 and any other amendments in the group. Bob.
Thank you, Convener. In relation to 187, I've been working with SCIAF on this particular amendment, and I thank them for their efforts. I mean, they are keen, and I agree that relevant policy makers, human rights defenders and environmental experts from the Global South should be consulted on in the development of our circular economy strategy. SCIAF have suggested participants from Scotland's partner countries such as Malawi, Zambia, Rwanda or Pakistan could be included. Now, I've not put any named countries on my amendment. I'm keen to have the amendment as flexible as possible to give it, maximise its opportunity to be useful to government and to make a meaningful contribution to making sure the Global South is properly consulted. Needless to say, those close to the harm caused by our consumption who understand global needs should be included in the process of development and implementation of our circular economy strategy. Circular economy strategy does not sit in isolation, Convener. A truly circular economy needs to take account of the impact on the Global South. We must look at it, if you like, through both ends of the telescope. I'm sure the Scottish Government will want to look at the impact on the Global South anyway, but that's through... Let me just finish this point and I'll take Mr Lumsden in. That's through our side of the telescope. We have to look at it directly from the Global South also, so we look at it from both sides of the lens at the same time. If you like, Mr Lumsden, did you want to come in?
Yes, I thank Bob Doris for taking the intervention. It's really just to try and get an understanding of what sort of... how the consultation would take place around that. And would it... Is there a chance that it would potentially delay the strategy going forward if you sort of widened the consultation out too far?
I thank Mr Lumsden for that question. I think I can offer some quite significant reassurances in relation to this, Mr Lumsden. And let me go on to give you an example in reassuring you. I wanted to mention the Glasgow Climate Dialogues that were held during COP26, where the Scottish Government and Glasgow City Council deliberately platformed the Global South when looking at the challenges that we had in relation to climate. There's a way of embedding our work with our key partners in the Global South into our everyday actions in relation to net zero and climate challenge. And by not specifying details on the face of the bill, Mr Lumsden, I think it gives a significant degree of flexibility to the Scottish Government to make sure they can embed that in a way that's not overly burdensome or time-consuming. I don't have much more to say on this, Convener, other than to ignore... I may have a little bit more to say on this now, Convener, Mr Simpson.
Can I thank Bob Doris for taking the intervention? I am going to refer to his amendment in my comments, but I just want him to clear up something for me, if he can. What does he mean by the Global South? Because I cannot find any precise definition of that. It could be a very long list of countries.
Well, I think that's a reasonable point and one that I anticipated would be made, perhaps not just by yourself, Mr Simpson, but also by the Minister when she refers to these comments. I didn't want to deviate from the wording that I had agreed with SCIAF, but I appreciate there may be a need for tightening up in relation to this. And as soon as anyone puts a definition on the Global South, by definition, you're perhaps excluding others. So I think you have to give a degree of latitude and flexibility to the Scottish Government in relation to this. And that's also why this may turn out to be a probing amendment, Minister, to perhaps be tightened up in the wording and brought back at stage three. But the important thing, and I'll leave it at this, is we need to make sure the co-design, I think, that was mentioned earlier on with other groups, we need to make sure the Global South, however we define that, Mr Simpson's part of those discussions, but not just on our terms, but hearing directly from them about what the real-life impact is on their part of the world. And with that, I'll draw my remarks to an end. Convener.
Thank you very much. I now call Sarah Boyett to speak to Amendment 188 and other amendments in the group. Sarah.
Thank you, Convener. Amendment 188 in my name would enable the Scottish Government to ensure that it had sought representations and views on the strategy from international organisations who are working in international development and on achieving the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals both here and across the globe. I think it's really important that this amendment is actually passed because we know that the actions of us here in Scotland can have an impact on populations across the globe. We know that waste is often sent offshore and that we essentially outsource our waste problem to developing countries. That doesn't just impact on their environment, it also incurs significant carbon emissions as a result. I've actually seen for myself the impact in Bangladesh of waste from Western countries literally dumped in the foreshore, and it's absolutely horrific. So my amendment ensures that the strategy that comes forward is consulted on with stakeholders with views on these issues and ensures that Scotland takes steps both now and in the future to ensure that we reduce the level of offshore waste and the carbon emissions associated with that waste. Now, Amendment 187 in the name of Bob Doris, I think he spoke very positively about the need to address this issue. I think it tries to achieve a similar aim. But in crafting my amendment, I tried to anticipate and reflect the fact that things do change and relevant stakeholders change. So I've tried to provide my flexibility in the amendment to reflect that, and it's not overburdensome to ministers to prove that they have consulted with relevant stakeholders representing the global impact. And I hope that would address the question that Douglas Lumsden raised there about what does the Global South mean? It would be up for ministers to engage in those conversations and to talk to companies that actually export waste from Scotland at the moment. So I hope members will think about supporting my Amendment 188. Really, other amendments in this group, I very much support Maurice Golden's co-design amendment and the suggestion that SEPA should review its waste guidance to ensure it's in line with the circular economy strategy. That's really fundamental because SEPA are hugely influential and it's important that as a key stakeholder of government that they are actually ahead of the game and making sure this bill is maximised in its impact. And in relation to Graeme Simpson's amendments, I spotted he's got a couple of amendments here giving us a choice. If it was up to me and I had a vote, I think his one-year proposal is probably better and more pragmatic in terms of the requirement for the publication of the strategy rather than 6 months. But if the Minister wants to override me and say that she was ready tomorrow, I would be more than happy to see what happens there. I know those remarks, Convener, I shall conclude.
Thank you very much, Sarah. And I now call on Graeme Simpson to speak to Amendment 2. And any other amendments in the group? Graeme.
Thanks a lot, Convener. As Sarah Boyack has just said, I've got a couple of amendments in the group which relate to Section 3 of the Bill entitled Publication and Laying of Strategy. Now, the Bill, as published, says that ministers must publish the Circular Economy Strategy and lay a copy of it before the Parliament within 2 years of Section 3 coming into force. Now, in my view, that displays a lack of ambition and a pace of working that really should have no place in government. Convener, it's real life in the slow lane stuff, and it's not good enough. And I'm sure the Minister now in charge would agree with me on this. I hope so. So Amendments 2 and 3 are alternatives, and they reduce that rather ponderous timescale to either 1 year or 6 months, and I invite the committee to take their pick. Of course, the committee could, if they wish, revert to the old Lorna Slater timetable, or they could turbo boost the bill under the dynamism of Gillian Martin, and I hope she proves me right on that. Now, Maurice Golden invites us to agree that the circular economy... Yes, I certainly will.
Oh, grateful to Graeme Simpson. I hear he's inviting us into the fast lane with him, but is he not a little bit concerned that 6 months might just be a little too much of a challenge? You know, we want the government, any government, to be able to do this properly. Is 6 months really reasonable?
Well, I would say to Monica Lennon, that's why I have provided the committee with a choice.
And do you have, does Graeme Simpson have a preference?
1 year.
And what would your preference be? Are you...
That is entirely up to the committee, but if we're to be take the pragmatic approach suggested by Sarah Boyack... Yes,
no, I'm just saying this is becoming a conversation, and I get nervous when we're doing stage two debates of conversations. So if I could remind you to do it through the chair, I'd appreciate.
Sorry, I can't see Graeme's face at this moment in time, but my question was around, does Mr Simpson have a preference? He's got two amendments he's offering as a choice. Does he have a strong preference?
Well, I'm always happy to have conversations with Miss Lennon. She knows that. But I was going to go on to say that if we're to take the pragmatic approach suggested by Miss Boyack, and I am a pragmatist, then the committee would go for 1 year rather than 6 months. So if I had a preference, it would be a year. But there may be others who have a different view. Now, Maurice Golden invites us to agree that the circular economy strategy should be co-designed with the public sector, private sector and third sector bodies. I have to say I was a little surprised that Mr Golden had used that awful phrase, co-design, so favoured by those who want to sound well-meaning but don't really mean it. And he's not in that camp. He really isn't in that camp at all, being a circular economy titan. But phraseology aside, he's right to say that the production of any such strategy should not be left to ministers and civil servants alone. Now, turning to my good friend Bob Doris, Doris's amendment, number 187, which was absolutely fascinating. It also suggests people who should be consulted. I'm not really sure what he means by relevant policymakers or human rights defenders, which could mean almost anyone. But it's his call for environmental experts from the global south to be included, which has me most foxed. And he's not really cleared it up because he doesn't really... I will.
Yeah. I'm hoping we can stay away from turbo boosting and fast lanes or even titans at this point, as Mr Simpson was referring to earlier on. There's a policy intent within this amendment, and I absolutely acknowledge that having used the specific words that SCAF were keen to see at this stage on the face of the bill as a probing amendment, there's a need for much more clarity. But I think Mr Simpson's long in the tooth enough in this place to know what the underlying policy intent is, and that is those nations and those regions within the global south, however we define it, Mr Simpson, are the true experts in relation to much of this stuff, because they're experiencing the direct impacts of much of the climate challenges that we have today, and circular economy bill has to take that into account to be a truly circular economy strategy and bill. So would Mr Simpson confirm that despite the need for clarity and a bit more carefulness in relation to definitions, the underlying policy intent is a positive one? Because I'm not clear on whether Mr Simpson's issue is with the clarity or otherwise or the policy intent. Perhaps it's both.
Well, I'm glad Mr Doris has finished there. I think the most important thing is the language we use when we table amendments. And if we're going to table an amendment that has phrases like the global south, I would suggest, convener, you really ought to know what you mean by that. And I'm afraid it's not really good enough of Mr Doris to say, well, it's all down to SCIAF. And I don't really know. I don't really know what the global south means. Because if the... I will. If Mr Doris is prepared to clear up this point, then fine, I'll give way again.
I'm not... Mr Sims, I actually want to have consensus here. I genuinely don't think you're meaning to be obtuse. Perhaps you are. There's an underlying policy intent here about making sure the Global South, however we define it, and I've accepted the lack of clarity there, that they should be consulted. And yes, my rather lack of brevity in my last question was, does Mr Simpson agree with the policy intent? And that's still not something I'm clear of.
Well, the problem is I'm not clear what the policy intent is behind Bob Doris's amendment. I'm really not, and I'm pretty sure if the committee members have been listening as closely as I have, they would also be unclear. But what we can be clear about is if we go with this amendment, and I'm pleased to hear Mr. Doris is I think he's minded not to press it, but we'll discover that later. We could end up for ministers with a huge list of people that they are expected to consult across the globe, and a long list of countries. And I just think that's completely impractical. I'm pretty sure the minister will say that as well. So hopefully Mr. Doris will not press this amendment, and I will close it there. Thank you.
Thank you much, Graham. I now call on Mark Ruskell to speak to Amendment 189 and any other amendments in the group.
Yeah, thanks very much, Convener. Amendment 189 is a very simple amendment. It should be clear to members that the bill as drafted requires ministers to report to Parliament on progress in meeting the objectives under the strategy. But there is a gap here, so if ministers have been unable to meet their objectives, there, in my mind, needs to be an additional requirement that they must then report back to Parliament on what additional measures they'll take to achieve those objectives before the next reporting round. And members will note that's very similar to what we currently have in a range of legislation, including climate legislation. Just turning to the interesting debate about 187 and 188, I mean, I think the essence of this is about leadership, isn't it? It's about a dialogue with the Global South, who are, you know, dramatically impacted by our resource overconsumption and the environmental and social impact of waste. I'm not sure whether that needs legislation to do that. But I think, you know, Bob is right to point to the amazing work that was done through the Glasgow Dialogues ahead of COP26, which had real resonance around the world. And that was about, you know, the communities in the Global South, the experts, and us in the developed North as well, being part of that conversation about how we tackle climate change in a fair and just way. Hugely powerful, didn't require legislation to do it. But I think what I'm wanting to hear from the minister is that if the government doesn't want to go down a legislative route, what kind of initiatives can it put in place that actually take this debate and this awareness around consumption and the impacts of our consumption globally into a space where, yes, in a second, where it can actually land and actually make change. And I suppose I would also point to the recent climate package that was announced a couple of weeks ago. There's intention of the Scottish Government there to drive forward citizens' panels, citizens' assemblies, participative democracy in that space. Consumption is a very important part of our climate impact. So I would hope that there is some kind of initiative and leadership that can be shown on that. Yeah, give way to Sarah.
Hey, thank you very much for giving way. I think your points about leadership are absolutely critical. And COP26, I very much agree with you. Scotland put ourselves on the world stage in terms of best practice. The opportunity in this bill is to follow that best practice up by embedding in legislation, not just leadership, but the current and future governments having that obligation to have conversations to make sure that we are looking at not offshoring our emissions and our waste. And I hope you will consider supporting my amendment for that very principle to deliver on the issues you've just raised yourself. Thank you.
Well, I think the principle there is important. What I'm not clear about is what the options may be for government to take this forward as a meaningful piece of work. I mean, in the last Climate Act, we did put into legislation a requirement for a citizens' assembly, but I actually don't think going forward, for example, there would be a need for more legislation to revisit a citizens' assembly on climate. And I see parallels with this. You know, yes, bootstrap it, put it into legislation would be one way forward, but I'm looking for leadership from the Scottish Government, whatever it actually looks like, legislative or non-legislative. In terms of Amendment 2 and 3, I mean, as the inevitable tension between Maurice Gold and Graham Simpson on turbocharging co-design. I mean, I think we need to recognise that we have to take people with us, right? We have to take business with us. We have to take communities with us. There was a lot of careful work done in the early years
right the way through to the implementation of the deposit return scheme. And I think members that have sat in this committee have looked at the evidence, have heard the work of Lorna Slater, have scrutinised Circularity Scotland and others, will recognise that that model was being developed and it came very, very close to being implemented. That emphasises for me the importance of that co-design. It is important. I think government is pursuing co-design in a very meaningful way right now, but to simply put an arbitrary timescale on the development of a circular economy strategy, I think would, just for the sake of it, I think wouldn't be a good way forward. We need to see work progress at pace on all of the areas within the circular economy strategy, but that will take some time, and I think just putting 6 months or 1 year on it is a little churlish. It kind of underestimates the depth of the work, underestimates the depth of work that's needed with stakeholders to actually work this through, and the depth of work that was actually put in place, the deposit return scheme. Yes, Mr. Simpson.
Thank Martin Ruskell for taking the intervention. Would Martin Ruskell accept that there is actually already a timescale in the bill? It's 2 years. I'm just suggesting it should be 1 year or 6 months. Preferably 1 year, as I said earlier.
Well, I accept that you know, Mr. Simpson wants to put other options on the table, but what we've also heard in the debate today is that there's areas like construction where we've not seen enough significant progress. And to be honest, that is going to take time. It is going to take more than 6 months to... Hang on a minute, let me finish the sentence. It's going to take more than 6 months to actually develop a strategy around construction and to move into areas within the strategy where there perhaps hasn't been that focus and there hasn't been that development over time. I'm going to leave my comments there.
Okay. The answer is no, Mr. Golden. So therefore, I'm going to call Douglas Lumsden to speak to Amendment 80 and the other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. And it's really just my amendment is, I think is quite simple, and it's just changing the reporting period from 2.5 years down to 1 year. And I guess that's, you know, we hear talk often of a climate emergency and everything else. And so if we're serious about doing this, I think it is time about, I don't want to say turbocharging some of our timelines, but we really do need to up the pace. And that's why I'm proposing changing the reporting period down to 12 months. If we look at some of the other amendments in this grouping, I think the co-design approach that Maurice Golden mentions, working with local authorities, you know, that's, you know, they're going to be so vital for all of this, all this work we're doing. So I think that's absolutely key. And his other amendment about SEPA review, that once again, they're another key partner. So I think it's only, I think that's a fairly sensible approach. If we look at some of the other amendments in terms of 187 from Bob Doris, you know, I think it sounds good, but I think in practice, I think it's sort of unworkable. I think in the lead up to COP, I think it was probably a bit easier. People were getting together anyway. So I think it'll be a bit harder to do that in terms of looking at a circular strategy. Of course.
First of all, can I thank Mr. Lumsden for his tone and his constructive demeanour in relation to how he raises his concerns. There's an underlying policy intent here, which perhaps, as Mr. Ruskell says, may not have to be captured in legislation on the face of the bill, but would you agree, Mr. Lumsden, with the underlying intent to make sure, however we define it, without going down that road, to engage meaningfully with the Global South?
I agree with the intent. It's just what we have here in terms of the amendment you put forward, I believe, is unworkable. I don't see how it can be sort of brought forward. 189 also sounds good, but I think is workable, and I'll be happy to support that amendment going forward. And on the timescale, whether, you know, it's 6 months or 1 month, or sorry, 6 months, 1 year, or 2 years that Graham Simpson's mentioned, he's right to say, you know, we already have an arbitrary target. It is 2 years, so it's about reducing that target down. And I'd be happy to go, I think, on reflection, thinking about the 1 year period in my mind. Because I do think, you know, if we are serious about this, if we do believe there's urgent action needed, then we do need to be looking at these timescales and reducing them down as much as possible, but also remain practical. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. I'm looking to see if there's any other members of the committee who'd like to say anything. There's a couple of points I'd like to make, but I'm happy if, Monica, you'd like to go first.
Yeah, I mean, it was just an observation. I mean, I think Bob Doris has done some really important work with SCIAF and others on Amendment 187. Just listening to colleagues today, and I think it's right for Bob to be questioned about, you know, how this could be delivered. But I'm slightly concerned that some colleagues, you know, are maybe suggesting that they don't know what is meant by human rights defenders and what do we mean by the Global South. So I think it maybe makes the point of Amendment 187 that it's really important. No, in a second. I think it's really important that we mainstream this into our work. I think perhaps there could be some work done in terms of the language used in this amendment. I think it's the policy intent that's really important. I think we do all recognise that the impact of the climate and nature emergency falls disproportionately on nations and people in the Global South, including indigenous people who often are the human rights defenders who risk their lives day in, day out to defend their land and their culture and their loved ones. So I just wouldn't want anyone listening in to this today to think that we don't see the relevance and the connection of this. And it simply comes back to the polluter pays principle and that old phrase of thinking globally but acting locally. So I think it's really important, if we can't find a way today, and we haven't heard from the Minister on it yet, is that these are really important concepts. And I think many people look to Scotland as a leader around loss and damage, for example. So we have to, if we're not sure of the meaning, then we as members collectively have to work harder on it. But I'm grateful to hear from Douglas Thompson.
Thanks for taking the intervention. For me, it's not about maybe some of us not understanding the meaning or what it might be, but I guess it's, for me, it's we're putting this into legislation. So it's got to be clear what human rights defenders are or relevant policymakers are. And I think that's where I question in my head, you know, people coming along in 10 years' time, picking up this bill, thinking, well, hold on, am I a human rights defender or not? And I think that's why we have to be clear what goes into the legislation. And I think that's the key that's the area that's been raised, not some people not understanding what that might be.
So are you at the end of?
Yeah, I mean, I think there's obviously a debate to be required here, but I think, as ever, it's just important to go back to the stage one evidence and to look at the submissions that we've had from stakeholders who are expert in this area. And I'm sure that all colleagues here, given a bit more time and space, could find agreement on that. But it's really to hear from the Minister on that, Convener.
OK, there's a looking to see if any other members want to contribute. There's a couple of points that I would like to make, if I may. One on Amendment 187. I think it's an interesting amendment raised by Bob Doris, and I can understand where it's come from and the evidence that's been given. My problem is, as somebody who loves tight legislation because it stops arguments or disagreements. I believe there's 78 countries in the Global South. The original definition, if I've got it right, was to do with countries that suffered from poor economic development, probably lacked democracy, and location was a problem. Has since been changed to take into the word those people who were, or countries that have been affected by the development of more developed nations. I have real problems with it because I see countries that are surrounded by countries that are part of the Global South but aren't part of the Global South themselves. So they're excluded, although geographically they're in the same position. And so I would urge Mr. Doris, as a member of the committee, to reconsider whether that amendment is the correct way of defining it and perhaps bring it forward at stage three in a slightly different format. Mr. Doris, I'm happy to give way to you.
Thanks, Convener. And again, I would acknowledge that SCIAF had suggested as a starting point the partner countries in the Global South that Scotland already has relationships with. And I also acknowledge it's incredibly broadly drawn. That was quite deliberate, Convener. I've been very aware that it is, in fact, a probing amendment to flush out these concerns ahead of a revision at stage three. So I will take your sage advice on board in this instance, Convener.
Well, thank you, and I hope you take that was in the way it was meant. My other point is on Amendments 2 and 3, raised by Graeme Simpson. I think Amendment 2 and 3 are interesting. I think 2 is quite tight. Interestingly, we have the option of voting on Amendment 2 before we vote on Amendment 3. So if Amendment 2 fails, then Amendment 3 has the opportunity to pass. My problem as a parliamentarian looking to the future would be that the timescale within this bill would mean that the issue that Graeme Simpson is trying to address would not be brought forward till May 2026. Unless things go remarkably astray, May 2026 would when there would be an election. So this whole strategy would be launched after we've gone into recess, which for me brings sorts a huge heap of problems as far as allowing proper parliamentary scrutiny. So although I would love to turbocharge it, I think it's unrealistic to do so, I would definitely support 12 as an amendment to 2 years. And if both of those fail, I would see there's very good grounds for 18 months to ensure that this parliament is given the proper ability to scrutinise legislation before it goes into recess for an election. So those are my views. I'm looking around to see if there are any other views. There don't appear to be. So I call on the Minister to make any closing comments you wish to.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Members, for a really interesting discussion around the points that have been raised. Amendment 1 from Maurice Golden, as it stands, is something that the Government can't support. Co-design is not a term defined in legislation, and arriving at a workable definition is acceptable to all those engaged in co-design would be difficult, but would be time-consuming, and we want to get going. I won't quite use Graeme Simpson's terminology here. Consultation, of course, is going to be central. If you let me finish and maybe get a little bit of my points out before I take intervention. Consultation is going to be central to the development of a workable and meaningful circular economy strategy. And I absolutely agree that this should include private, public and third sector bodies. Section 2 of the bill already requires consultation with the general public and other persons the Scottish ministers consider appropriate when preparing the strategy, which would include public, private and third sector bodies. And the circular economy touches in every part of society, and I do support this principle of broad engagement. As such, I'm happy to reflect on what Mr. Golden has put forward and see how we can broaden the consultation requirements ahead of stage three. Although we can't support the wording as it is just now, I think there's movement there, and I absolutely get the point. I'll take Douglas Lumsden now if he wants to come in.
Yeah, thanks, Minister, for taking the intervention. It was just, I'm thinking, often here, co-design approach, I think, in terms of the National Care Service, I thought that was really embedded in it. So I'm surprised that wording can't be accepted in this amendment, even though I accept what you've said in just a latter points to Maurice Golden's amendment.
Mr. Lumsden rightly points out that co-design is something that could be happening across lots of areas of government and lots of, but there isn't an actual legal definition of that. It's a proposal in which you have stakeholder engagement in order to work a workable strategy. And the bills that you refer to are bills that enable that co-design. But I think hopefully he gets the point that I am in agreement with Mr. Golden on the wider point of actually widening out the consultation there, and I'm happy to do that. If I can now speak to Amendments 187 and 188 together, rightly recognises the impact decisions taken here in Scotland can have on the Global South, and it was good to hear so many members recognise that Scotland and Scottish Government have taken a leading role in that in their work, and Civic Scotland as well in COP26, but also in COP28 as well. We were the first country to put forward proposals on loss and damage around and really take that argument and that discussion about climate justice to the fore in everything that we do. Very important consideration. Climate justice is an important concern of our government across multiple portfolios. I fully appreciate the sentiment and the intention behind the amendment. I can't support it as it stands and as it's written, because the very broad way in which it's framed would make identifying the relevant stakeholders and experts in the Global South too uncertain in legal terms and not possible for ministers to probably identify statutory consultees. But we always listen, and we'll always listen to the views of stakeholders in the Global South. And I just want to make reference to the fact that Ms Slater, in taking this bill forward, as she did from the start, had that engagement and consultation with stakeholders thoroughly until the point at which it was handed over to myself. And those, of course, we'll always listen to representative organisations. And I think it's been a really useful discussion. With regard to Amendment 188, I appreciate the sentiment. It's framing of persons or organisations that may be affected or interested by the strategy, in particular international organisations. Again, it's too broad a description to be deliverable. The consultation requirement in the bill already requires ministers to consult such persons as they consider appropriate and would therefore allow ministers to consult international organisations. Indeed, we consult international organisations and we engage with international partners. Many ministers do across their daily work. So as with Amendment 1, I'm happy to consider further whether we can work together to broaden that consultation, those consultation requirements ahead of Stage 3 and include the kinds of categories of persons envisaged in these amendments, and hopefully we can arrive at something that we're all in agreement with. Amendment 189 from Mark Ruskell. I believe that this will strengthen the reporting requirements for the circular economy strategy, and thank Mr Ruskell for putting it forward. I think it adds value to the bill, so happy to accept that and support it. Amendments 2 and 3 relate to Section 3 of the bill, which currently requires ministers to publish the circular economy strategy and lay it before Parliament within 2 years of the section coming into force. So effectively, this provision in the bill gives ministers and stakeholders 2 years to develop the strategy, including that stakeholder engagement, consultation, analysis of responses, revision of the draft strategy in light of those responses. Yeah,
it's really striking when you look back that the first circular economy strategy was produced in 2016. There's been a huge amount of consultation on this bill. So aren't we at a point where ministers could actually just crack on? Because it's been observed already 2 years, not even just from now, but from when this bill's actually approved and adopted. It's actually quite a long time off and you're into the next term of the Parliament. So again, there's something about leadership and getting moving on this really critical agenda.
So on the one hand, I agree that there's lots that can be started now because there's been a great deal of engagement. But throughout this morning, there's been lots of references to where there's not been movement and there's not been sufficient engagement. In fact, within this group that we're talking about here, members are asking for the consultation to be opened even wider than it already has been. So allowing 2 years for the development of a strategy, I think, is reasonable. The intention would be to engage with that wide range of stakeholders developing the strategy, assessing the likely impacts. And I don't want to curtail that vital engagement. Indeed, I'm taking on board quite a lot of what's been said this morning about extending it.
Will the Minister take an intervention?
I'll come to you in a second. I just really want to get to the end of my point here. Graham Simpson, I'm not about the fast lane, personally. I'm about going in the right direction with stakeholders behind me and about that careful consideration that Mark Ruskell mentioned. Consultation time period set out in guidance for statutory environmental assessments under the Environmental Assessment Scotland Act alone could take 6 months. For these reasons, we don't support those two amendments, and I would ask Graham Simpson not to press them. I think that we rush things at our peril, to be honest. Convener.
Thank you very much, Minister, for taking the intervention. My point that producing a strategy as the Parliament goes into recess for an election, will you take that point? And if you want to argue the 6 or the 12 month, which I can perhaps understand, if you at least changed it to 18 months or made an amendment to change it to 18 months, you would ensure that this Parliament and the very people who have given so much time and effort to ensuring this is correct, including people on this committee, get a chance to express a view.
I listened to the convener, but I am wryly smiling because if things went a certain way last week, we would have been looking at a Scottish Parliament election in a few weeks.
And so, as you well know, Minister, I'm not going to take that because you interrupted me slightly, and there still would have been an election in 2026, so it would have come about. I'm trying to de-conflict the two, which I would suggest is the correct way to do it.
Convener, Minister. I'm sorry if you thought I interrupted you. I thought you had finished. So what I would say is that, Convener, you've made your point. I'll take your point. The idea of 18 months has been mooted here. It's not in either of the amendments, but to the two amendments, I would ask Graeme Simpson not to press them, although I imagine that he will. Convener, for similar reasons, the Scottish Government cannot support Amendment 80 from Douglas Lumsden. Section 5 of the bill requires that Scottish ministers report in relation to progress in respect of objectives and plans in the circular economy strategy 30 months after the publication of each strategy. This means that there is a requirement for a progress report at the halfway point of each strategy. Now, I think this represents a balance between ensuring the Scottish Government is accountable for progress on each circular economy strategy, whilst not imposing onerous reporting burdens that distract from delivering policy. And our view is that Amendment 80, in imposing annual reporting on the strategy, would go too far in that direction and should be resisted. Yes.
Does the Minister not feel, though, that by leaving the report in time too long, 2.5 years, that we may be seriously off track by the time that reporting's done, and that gives us less time to really to adjust? And by having a year reporting, you can actually see how far away you are from your targets, and then make changes to make sure you're back on track.
Well, we have the halfway point reporting requirements, and I think that they are sufficient. Members are always welcome to write to ministers to ask for updates on how targets are being met in the intervening period. And I think that that strikes a balance. To Amendment 190 from Maurice Golden, the circular economy is at the heart of SEPA's published waste to resources framework, and that framework's recognised that SEPA has a clear role in helping Scotland move to a more circular economy, and it's in a unique place to ensure Scotland's environment is protected whilst helping to create the prosperity from greater resource efficiency. So I just want to go through the framework. It already guides SEPA's work in waste and resources, and SEPA guidance already takes into account a circular economy where resources are recirculated in the context of high levels of environmental protection. There are over 100 individual pieces of SEPA guidance that relate to waste management activities, generally on legal, technical and pollution issues, for example, on interpreting legal definitions, practical guidance on consigning special waste, landfill waste, acceptance criteria, odour abatement, or on whether a recycled product like compost ceases to be waste. And it also includes guidance on UK schemes such as producer responsibility. He says this was a nudge in the direction, but actually I think hopefully I've demonstrated that SEPA already has this absolutely embedded in all their activities. All this guidance already takes into account the regulator's code of practice, SEPA's statutory purpose and its waste resources framework, and requiring all waste guidance to be reviewed would be a significant undertaking with the prospect of no significant change, given SEPA's guidance is already in line with that waste to resources framework. And SEPA will also be involved and consulted on the development of the strategy. So in short, it's my belief that this is, amendment is unnecessary and could be overly burdensome on SEPA, and on that basis I cannot support it. Yes.
Thanks, Minister. So just for the record, you're confident, Minister, that there'd be no examples where across Scotland where
bits of kit, for example, from the oil and gas sector being landed in Aberdeen, been defined by SEPA as waste, but could be argued from a circular economy perspective as products and indeed valuable products which could be resold, but due to an interpretation by SEPA, which could and is often through a different interpretation through the Environment Agency, is not defined as waste for a very similar practice. Is it on the record that that just never occurs in Scotland?
Well, Mr. Golden is welcome to interrogate and to ask SEPA about their decisions. It's not really for me to answer on behalf of SEPA about an example that I don't have the detail on. So if you forgive me, Mr. Golden, I won't walk into that one. Thank you.
Interested to hear the Minister put on the record that there's already a lot of waste guidance that SEPA has on its books. My understanding of the amendment was around the procedure for review to ensure that SEPA's guidance remains aligned with the circular economy strategy. That's my interpretation of this. So I wonder if the Minister could maybe explain to members today what she sees as the mechanism going forward for SEPA to make sure that their guidance and how it's used remains up to date, particularly if there's, a lot of guidance on the books already. I suppose it's just a bit of reassurance around the capacity and the schedule around ensuring that guidance remains fit for purpose and aligned with the circular economy strategy.
I didn't have quite the same interpretation as Monica Lennon did on Maurice Golden's amendment there, and it was requiring all that guidance to be reviewed. And Ms. Lennon talks about capacity, and I think that's the thing that I would be worried about if we were asking them to review all of this when it's already in place and we already have a framework embedded into what SEPA does, that it would require... No, I'm answering Ms. Lennon, if you would forgive me. And I think that the Regulator's Code of Practice... The waste to resources framework is that mechanism that Ms. Lennon wants to know. And obviously, SEPA will be working to review a framework in line with any changes to this legislation and to and in response to the strategy that we're going to produce as well. But we've maybe got a different interpretation on the intention of this amendment, so that's why I can't support it, because our interpretation is slightly different. Convener.
Concluded, Minister. Thank you. So I'm going to turn to Maurice Golden to wind up and press or withdraw his Amendment 1. Maurice Golden.
Thanks for that. I'm quite happy to withdraw Amendment 1. Overall, I think in this group of amendments, I think to Bob Doris's, I think an enhanced duty of care by SEPA might help to improve the traceability of waste and perhaps reference to global supply chains rather than the global south. I think in terms of the timescales aspect, I mean, I think we should be aware that, particularly given that the purpose clauses were withdrawn, essentially the circular economy strategy, as defined by the bill at this moment in time, is a waste and litter strategy. So it's not going to be transformational. It's very much a rehash of existing strategies and, unfortunately, branded as a circular economy strategy, but that's where we are. So that's the scope at the moment, as far as I can tell. It's had 8 years in the making, and we do have a climate emergency on our hands. So taking all that into account, I would imagine the strategy as that is very well, much drafted, and therefore it could be done very quickly. I appreciate the Minister's points around consultation periods around said strategy, if they, that could undoubtedly delay things. But in terms of a starter for 10, with 8 years, I would think dozens of people working on it, it's pretty much good to go, subject to amendments, which could change things or not. I think on the SEPA guidance, if the circular economy strategy is already embedded, then it's a really quick process to review. If it's already there, there's actually very little to be done. So I would urge that. But I would also gently point out the whisky industry doesn't produce waste, it produces byproducts. If that sort of approach from SEPA was applied to other sectors, again, mitigations for which SEPA have to do, health and safety, any pollutants. But if that general approach where you don't produce waste, you produce byproducts, then that would actually help to fulfil the circular economy. And I may well come back with, at stage three with some further examples of that. AstroTurf's a good one, wind turbine blades is another one, where we can really ensure that, that you know, my interpretation is that SEPA have a little bit more to do. The Minister's made clear that it's already there. If it's already there, then the amendment won't change anything.
Thank you very much, Mr. Golden. So I just want to confirm that you wish to withdraw Amendment 1.
Yes.
So Maurice Golden seeks to withdraw Amendment 1. Does any member object to the amendment being withdrawn? There are no objections, so therefore the amendment is withdrawn. I therefore call Amendment 141 in the name of Maurice Golden, grouped with Amendment 151. Maurice Golden to move Amendment 141 and speak to both amendments in the group.
Thank you. So, short little group. This one, just two amendments. Essentially, the motivation around these two amendments is to, in some way, shape or form, recreate the UK Committee on Climate Change for the circular economy. So I think what we've seen is the impartiality of that body really working wonders in terms of holding the Scottish Government and the UK Government to account on net zero. I think there is a role for such a body in Scotland around the circular economy, and I struggle to see how other bodies could fulfil this. And this is based on my experience within the sector over a number of years. And if you look at, for example, the funding through Waste Aware Scotland, RAP and Zero Waste Scotland, who've essentially fulfilled similar functions, but actually drastically changeable functions over the years, even though the Scottish Government since 2007 has been consistent and in control. And today, construction's been mentioned a lot, and I think members might be surprised that the construction support programme from Zero Waste Scotland, to my recollection, has been cancelled twice. So it's been started, Scottish Government have taken a review, ditched and restarted and ditched, and I'm not aware of its current status. It may well be. But the similar situation goes for textiles as well, and I think the advisory body could provide a role which would be particularly helpful for this committee in terms of scrutinising government policy and critically application of policy, because you might assume there'd be consistency of policy being applied when you've got the same government in charge. And definitively in this space, it's not. Another major change, which I will do, but I just want to finish this point about consistency. Another major change has been to divert millions of pounds from supporting local authorities to supporting businesses. Now, I don't comment on whether that's correct or incorrect, but again, we have a lot of amendments in this group around supporting local authority funding. Well, that is, at least in part, as a result of a change in emphasis which wasn't scrutinised by Parliament. Probably people wouldn't even know that those quite major changes in policy application were even going on. And I think an advisory body has a role in scrutinising that and actually making it transparent. So if there is a decision, a policy intention has changed, which is quite legitimate for government to do, then I think we and the people of Scotland deserve to know about it. I'll go to Mark and then I'll come to Graham.
Thank Maurice for giving way. I suppose what I'm looking for
between stage two and stage three then is just a bit more detail on this. I mean, I'm not really clear at this point how an advisory body would work with Zero Waste Scotland, given Zero Waste Scotland's existing role. I'm not sure about how much this would cost. I'm not sure about whether this is best done on a Scotland-wide basis or a UK-wide basis in terms of resources. So I suppose those are the areas of uncertainty.
I think in terms of Zero Waste Scotland, I mean, again, I'm happy to work with the government on this. I think Zero Waste Scotland's a not-for-profit company, private company. So we need to be cautious at this moment in time, which is largely, at least in my understanding, largely relying on the Scottish Government for funding. And therefore, you can imagine that in terms of managing risk for that individual company, that they are very much have to do what the Scottish Government asked them to do, because the Scottish Government's paying them in the main. So I think that's there a kind of, but I would see the advisory body would utilise the excellent reports that Zero Waste Scotland produced, the analysis that they have, and indeed you'll have seen that firsthand for yourself. So I think they can be useful to that function and body, but I appreciate there's certainly more work to be done in terms of flesh to the bones. I'll go to Graham next, and then I'll come to Monica.
Yeah, thanks. I think it just follows on from that. So my question is, do you see this body as being one of the existing bodies or something brand new?
I think it would be useful to be brand new and therefore independent. I appreciate Mark Ruskell's point about, yes, could it be done at a UK-wide level? That might make more sense, but we'd also need to have a circular economy strategy at a UK-wide level. Could it be a function of the UKCCC as another alternative? That could be an existing body. My reticence around Zero Waste Scotland would be that essentially government would be asking and funding essentially themselves to tell them how they're doing at delivering policy, and that's, while circular, isn't the sort of circularity we want. Monica.
Thank you. I think you've partly answered my question. So you've clarified that your intention is a new body that would be independent and not funded by Scottish Government. So my question then would be, in terms of the funding model, what do you anticipate that to be? And my second question is, given you've mentioned the UK Climate Change Committee, is that something you've discussed with the UK Climate Change Committee?
No, I haven't. But I think it would be worthwhile either joint funding on a UK-wide basis, if possible. It may be that it is required to be funded by the Scottish Government because there's nobody else to fund it. It may be there's other sources of funding in that, but I think that's a matter depending on how the amendments are progressed or not.
On that point, Maurice Golden, because you've said that you want this to be independent of government and you think the funding flow is important, so I'm just wondering if we've been asked to support something that's fully independent in terms of its remit and its funding model, or would you be comfortable with something that was set up as being independent but was fully or partly funded by the Scottish Government?
Yes, that might be a necessity in the similar ways that you get the independent commissioners, for example.
Okay.
Like Commissioner for Veterans is a good example of that, where it is funded, but it's also independent as well. I think that's slightly different from something like Zero Waste Scotland, where the Scottish Government's funding their entire functions and having a specific body or entity that is designed to scrutinise the government. Does that make sense in terms of how it would formulate? Yes, Jackie.
When you said Commissioner for Veterans, is that meaning you're wanting a Commissioner for this?
No.
Or it was just...
I was just an example where the Scottish Government could fund something that I think most members would agree is independent but is also funded by the Scottish Government. I don't think that the two can sit alongside each other.
Thanks for the clarity.
It was just to ask about, is there the opportunity for Zero Waste Scotland to be reconfigured so that it's both able to use the expertise that's clearly in Zero Waste Scotland, which is of huge benefit, but give it that independence at the same time on this issue, so that just thinking about the setting up new organisations, we have to be very thoughtful about it and totally get the ambition behind your amendment, but just want to tease out the implications of other ways to deliver this. Thank
you. In short, yes, and that's why the amendment makes clear that it could be a public body. That's the only thing I would say. So obviously, Zero Waste Scotland's on the journey towards that, but isn't currently a public body. But I think Zero Waste Scotland, it could well be an opportunity reconfigured to fulfil that task. And you know, it's not uncommon in, for example, lawyers' offices to have Chinese walls in terms of the ability to ensure that even in the same offices there's an ability to scrutinise. I think that would be another opportunity, perhaps, for Zero Waste Scotland.
Thank you, Mr Golden. And every member, well, a lot of members have had a chance to debate, and I'm not seeing anyone wanting to come in, so I'm going to go to the Minister now. Minister.
Thank you, Convener. These amendments relate to the designation of either a new advisory body or an existing body to provide advice to Scottish ministers on their functions in relation to the circular economy strategy and targets, as we've heard. It seems to be envisaged that it would be similar to the role of the existing Climate Change Committee and the role that fulfils under the Climate Change Scotland Act 2009. And I acknowledge that it's extremely important to regularly monitor and report on the strategy and targets, but I don't agree that it's necessary for a new advisory body to be established for the purposes set out in the amendment. Section 5 of the bill requires ministers to lay out a report on progress before the Scottish Parliament halfway through the expected 5-year duration of the circular economy strategy. And Section 7 provides for regulations to set out reporting towards achieving circular economy targets, and such report must also be laid before the Scottish Parliament. I don't consider that setting up a new body would be a good use of taxpayers' money. And we already have several existing circular economy bodies that are fulfilling similar roles. And this was a conclusion we came to in considering responses to the bill consultation. If you just let me finish, make my point, and I'll bring you in. This was a conclusion we came to in considering the responses to the bill consultation, which asked about the establishment of a new circular economy public body, where concern was raised that it could duplicate existing provision and lead to unnecessary administration and cost. If I just go through, Scotland already has a relatively new independent body, Environmental Standards Scotland, which scrutinises and assesses the effectiveness of environmental law and public authorities' compliance with it, and is accountable to the Scottish Parliament. Progress against waste and recycling targets and development of the circular economy is an analytical priority within ESS's existing strategic plan, and the Climate Change Committee itself typically includes recommendations regarding circular economy and waste as part of its duties under the Climate Change Scotland Act 2009. And finally, Zero Waste Scotland has been mentioned a lot. It already provides advice and support to ministers in delivery of their objectives. And I just want to mention, I think it was mentioned about construction, they are already working on construction waste and engage with businesses on best practice. I'm not sure who it was that was trying to intervene in me. I don't know if it was Mr Golden.
My intention with this isn't in itself to create an advisory body. It's around scrutiny and application of government policy on a consistent basis. And what we've seen is that, and I know this firsthand, when the textiles programme was stopped, then people are worried about their jobs. And that in itself is a waste of money. So I don't know if the Minister's got any thoughts on how we get the consistency in application, which is ultimately my intent with these amendments.
I take Maurice Golden's point and the intention around it. I mean, I just go back to the point that there are a range of bodies fulfilling similar roles. I don't consider that as an option of designating an existing body as the advisory body. And there's no one body that would fit the kind of body envisaged in those amendments. Environmental Standards Scotland assesses public authorities' compliance with environmental law, is accountable to the Scottish Parliament. It's not been set up to give advice to ministers, but I want to make the point that Zero Waste Scotland already provides advice and support to ministers in the delivery of the objectives, and I won't rehearse everything that I've said. I'd also note that while the committee mentioned in its Stage 1 report the strong views from some stakeholders about creating an independent oversight body, it didn't consider the issue had sufficient importance to include within the committee's report recommendations as well. So for those reasons, the government does not support amendments 141 and 151. I'll take Graeme Simpson.
Thank the Minister for taking the intervention. It's just for clarity, the actual wording of Maurice Golden's amendment 151 is not to set up a new body, it's to designate a body to be an advisory body. Now, I've heard what the Minister has to say, but is she against that principle of having an advisory body?
So Zero Waste Scotland, which will complete its transition to become a non-departmental public body this year, and that's going to be taken forward in Amendments 174 and 180, is Scotland's circular economy expert and already provides advice and support to ministers in delivery of the objectives in this area. Thank you, Convener.
Mr Golden, you're about to wind up, I fear, and the Minister, I think, had come to a natural conclusion. So I'm conscious that everyone wants to debate this, and it's great that they do want to, but there are some constraints. So I am going to ask you to wind up, and maybe you can make your point there, and press or withdraw your amendment 141, Mr Golden.
Thanks. I think it's been a really useful discussion. I think it must be noted that it could be an existing body, as suggested in the amendment. I think there's more in this in terms of consistency of application of both funding and in policy direction in sector plans, and ultimately I think an advisory body would be useful. However, given the comments, I would seek to not move 141 and 151.
Okay, thank you. So the member, sorry. Yeah, you've got the thing there. Sorry, I acknowledge that you wish to withdraw Amendment 141. So Maurice Golden seeks to withdraw Amendment 141. Does any member object to the amendment being withdrawn? No one objects. Therefore, we'll move straight to Amendment 187 in the name of Bob Dorris, already debated with Amendment 1. Bob Dorris to move or not move?
Not moves, Convener.
Thank you. I therefore call Amendment 188 in the name of Sarah Boyack, already debated with Amendment 1. Sarah Boyack to move or not move?
Not moved, Convener.
Not moved. The question is that Section 2 be agreed. Are we all agreed? Yes, we are. I therefore call Amendment 2 in the name of Graeme Simpson, already debated with Amendment 1. Graeme Simpson to move or not move?
Not moved.
Not moved. Thank you. I therefore call Amendment 3 in the name of Graeme Simpson, already debated with Amendment 1. Graeme Simpson to move or not move?
Moved.
The amendment is moved. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. Therefore, there will be a division. Those in favour, raise their hands. Those against, raise their hands. Thank you. There are 3 votes for, 4 votes against. Therefore, the amendment is not agreed. The question is that Section 3 be agreed. Are we all agreed? We agreed. The question is now that Section 4 be agreed. Are we all agreed? I now call Amendment 189 in the name of Mark Ruskell, already debated, with Amendment 1. Mark Ruskell to move or not move?
Moved.
Moved. The question, therefore, is that Amendment 189, are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I therefore call Amendment 80 in the name of Douglas Lumsden, already debated, with Amendment 1. Douglas Lumsden to move or not move?
Move.
The question is, are we all agreed on Amendment 80?
No.
We're not agreed, therefore there'll be a division. Those in favour, raise your hands. Those against, raise their hands. Thank you. There are 2 votes for and 5 votes against, therefore the amendment is not agreed. The question is, Section 5 be agreed. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. Therefore, I call Amendment 190 in the name of Maurice Golden, already debated with Amendment 1. Maurice Golden, to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 190 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour, raise their hands. Those against, raise their hands. There are 3 votes for and 4 votes against, therefore the amendment is not agreed. Now, we have got to a stage where there is a logical break in the scrutiny of the Stage 2 amendments of the Circular Economy Bill. The problem is, I could go on a bit longer, but we'll get into a big, long section which we won't complete, and therefore that's why I'm stopping it here. I just say to committee members and to the Minister, I will need to speak with the clerks post this meeting. I think we are behind where we intended to be by this stage, and therefore I would just like to put it on record that we will have to consider an early start next week if we're not going to get there, considering that we have allowed within the timetable of 3 weeks for the debate of Stage 2 amendments, and we're at the end of week 1. So I'd like to thank you, Minister, and your officials, and conclude the meeting of the Stage 2 of consideration of the Circular Economy Bill. Timing for next week will be published, and we will start at the Circular Economy Targets, Duty to Make Regulations, and pre-laying procedure for first regulations. Thank you very much, and I close the meeting.